Ladies and gentlemen, we're about to begin. Please take your seat. Thank you.
Hello, everyone. It's really our honor and privilege to have Professor Ruti Taitel to be our keynote speaker this afternoon after 3 days of trial, and particularly in the closing section of the trial. Both parties mentioned the importance of transitional justice. And then at that particular moment, I thought it was really, really important for us to invite Professor Ruti Taitel to be the keynote speaker for this afternoon. Apparently, everybody now is reflecting upon transitional justice. Professor Ruti Taitel is actually a person without the need to introduce. But nevertheless, I will do briefly. Professor Taitel is a professor at the New York Law School. She has devoted herself in publishing a lot of books. One of the books translated in Chinese. And then yesterday, she had such a wonderful experience meeting her young audience in Taiwan. The main topics of her publication are along the line with international human rights law, law of war, international humanitarian law, and transitional justices. All of these issues, I will have to say, are most difficult issues and requiring the courage and persistence of law professors to continuously deal with, not only theoretically, but in terms of the real context, real situations, and these issues require a daring personality to face up to real and sometimes confrontational situations and contexts, and to try to understand and then sit back and realize and develop theories based upon all these situations. So we are really delighted to have Professor Ruti Taitel to talk this afternoon on truth, justice, and civil society, a topic couldn't be more proper for this occasion. As you all know, this Asian human rights court simulation is a such an unprecedented undertaking supported by lawyers, human rights organizations, and many, many civil societies, not only from Taiwan, but also from Asia. So it's really about a right timing for us to reflect if the truth is not only owned by the competent authorities, in what way the truth can be owned and sought after by the civil society to the most right versions of justice. So will you join me with a big round of applause and welcoming Professor Ruti Taitel.
So I should use this? Let's see. It's on. That might be easier then. Hi, is this on? Yeah? Thank you so much, Judge Wen and Cheng, and Judge and Professor. Yes, yes, I understand. Thank you as well to Judge Jade Su, Karen, and others in the project, and to the faculty at Academia Sinica, who also helped in bringing me here at this very auspicious time in your democracy. I spent yesterday with the Truth Commissioners, the Transitional Justice Commission, and with the students that came to the bookstore for my book, and was really impressed and gratified by the interest in the society on issues of justice in the current moment. So, without further ado, truth, justice, and civil society, I want to start with two images of justice, often these are seen as opposite. One is the Nuremberg trials, the other is the South African Truth and Reconciliation Commission. One is post-war punishment and where the Allies applied justice to the losers. And the other was really a majority consenting to no punishment, but a more conciliatory approach that would emphasize the truth. And this is something that is often very appealing. Maybe some of you have seen the film Nelson Mandela, Desmond Tutu. It's a very appealing idea of civil society coming together and of people volunteering. And so the agreement there was full disclosure of political offenses in exchange for amnesties. Sometimes people, this can be confused with forgiveness and religious understandings. It really wasn't. The law was full disclosure of past offenses in exchange for amnesties. Now, what I want to suggest is, while these are often contrasted, you know, the idea of punishment run by states, four allied states or follow-on trials run by the state versus truth and reconciliation, I want to suggest that at the end of the day, civil society is behind all of these efforts. Sometimes civil society is helping the state, and other times, which I want to emphasize in light of your project, it's civil society on its own able to promote justice by producing investigations and documentation and then handing it over to either an international court or later on a truth commission and so on. And that almost all of these examples involve civil society at its core. And I will go even further and say that civil society in the last two decades, and by civil society we mean sometimes international actors, multilateral actors, UN and so forth, civil society includes you all, students, professors, artists, journalists, human rights groups, NGOs. At the end of the day, what we've seen in the last 30 years is a new definition of the duties of the state as a result of the efforts of civil society. And in particular, this came out of, I'm going to describe some examples from my home area, which is Latin America. My family's from Argentina, and that's what took me into these topics. It was not an academic pursuit in the beginning. It was really interest in the role of the mothers in Argentina and how they were decrying and denouncing the loss of their loved ones, the disappeared there. And I'm going to get to that in a second. So let me just start with, Nuremberg, very well-known case, but most students today would not know the name of anyone prosecuted at Nuremberg, okay? And by the way, Hitler was not one of them. You know, he took, mostly leaders take care of their own lives. They don't want to be seen as humiliated at the hands of the opposite side. So what is it about? It was about truth. There are many volumes of documentation that came out of the Nuremberg trials, but how did they get that documentation? They didn't have any time during the trials. I was just in Nuremberg a year ago. It was the 70th anniversary of those trials. And of course, the Tokyo trials are more complicated still, right, of what went on there and the speed and the accusations of bias and so forth. But in terms of what came out of these multi-volume of documentation, Robert Jackson, the chief prosecutor who was lent to Nuremberg, American jurist, he said, and he was on the Supreme Court in the U.S. before he was at those trials, he said, "We will not ask you to convict these men on the testimony of their foes. We will not convict based on testimony of the allies." Okay, very important. Where did the testimony come from? The documentation came from the Germans themselves. Now, that was an unusual case where you had so much documentation produced by them because they were convinced of the legitimacy of what they were doing, and the cases could be brought without really a lot of need for oral testimony. You had a lot of documentation. But I think it's an interesting statement. Now, What happens after that? International justice is frozen pretty much during the Cold War. And the first post-Cold War international tribunal, the ICTY, as it's called, the International Criminal Tribunal for the former Yugoslavia, very difficult holding a tribunal during war. Okay, many of you may have heard of it. Systemic use of torture. Torture, rape, systemically used as policy by the leaders. Basically, for those who may not have heard, when the Soviet bloc collapsed, end of communism in some part of the world, Eastern Europe, and the satellites, when that collapsed, Yugoslavia blew up. And you had ethnic violence and politically motivated violence throughout the region. But how to prove these crimes? I actually was a war crimes observer on television for the first case, Duško Tadić, and it was Court TV. Stephen Brill was the head of Court TV, and he wanted to say that the O.J. Simpson case was not the trial of the century, that this should be the trial of the century. I said, okay, let's go, let's try, okay? I didn't have satellite TV at home, so I thought, okay, I'll get to see the hearings. And there was, you know, not much American interest in this, but the whole question is, how do you document torture and rape and murders, persecution during wartime? Very difficult. Now, how did they do it? A lot of it relied on civil society. Human rights groups went in and documented. They went to the battlefield. You also had testimony from experts and historians at the tribunal. And the UN itself had an expert commission that predates the tribunal. And the experts went in, and they were the ones that produced many pages of reports showing, that, in fact, with respect to rape, that there had been six types of rape used in wartime, because the point was that this was used even for genocidal purposes in order to stop continuation of Muslim citizens in that region. So the UN documentation, the witnesses, experts, all drawing from civil society, working together with this tribunal. And I think this is the underside of tribunals that we often neglect. And it has become a very important part of NGO work, is to cooperate and work with human rights courts and be able to take their investigation. In fact, it has resulted in a higher standard of evidence that they have to rely on, that they have to produce in order to do this. Now, let me turn to domestic trials and civil society and the pursuit of truth and justice. So, a very difficult period, and it involved an entire continent, was the period in the 80s in Latin America, 70s and 80s, where many of you may know, it was plunged into military rule, okay? The image that comes out of that period is the hooded image of the disappeared, the person who was abducted, kidnapped. The Spanish word is desaparecido, disappeared. And disappeared was a subject and a verb, okay, to disappear someone. And that is such a shocking offense, the idea that the state could disappear someone completely. So, but what was particularly complex, and there was often use of torture, but the question is, how could you prove any of this this happening? And it was a policy throughout the region. In fact, when people were abducted, sometimes in Argentina, and I've met with civil society members, mothers who had, like, let's say, three children, and let's say the first one was abducted in Argentina, and they would move the other one for safekeeping to Uruguay, abducted in Uruguay. The military were connected. The operation, the policy was called Operation Condor, and that's what the crime included. Not just abduction, but torture, and then killing and cover up. Okay. Now, part of what was the critical thing here is, how do you prove a crime when you don't have a smoking gun and you don't even have a body? And often witnesses, there were witnesses of abduction, office members, school pals who saw people taken and shoved into cars, but they might be afraid to testify at the time because they too would be taken. So part of the question, the first trial in Argentina may be known to you. It was the trial of the junta, the military junta. And in fact, the deputy chief prosecutor in that case became the chief prosecutor of the International Criminal Court. He was the first chief prosecutor. He's someone I know well, Luis Moreno Ocampo. And I met him when he was just stepping down from the junta trials. Now, how could they try this? And these were very famous trials, and in particular because there's so few domestic trials of their own brass. If you think about it, you can probably count them on one hand when you have the trials from that same country of the prior military regime. Now, in America, we have a handful of military trials, but even after the end of the Civil War, there were very few trials of the Southerners that committed war crimes. So how do you do it? And even in Eastern Europe, after the end of change, very few trials. So it's really an exception. And again, the underside of these trials that people don't see is the civil society documentation that the junta, the prosecutors relied on. And what was that? The trials, by the way, ended up being very important. And I'll say how the truth was released to civil society. But let's just, how did it happen? Well, preceding the trial in Argentina was the Truth Commission. You just now have a Transitional Justice Commission in Taiwan. It's not exactly the same as a Truth Commission, but it may lead to a Truth Commission. And in Argentina, the Truth Commission was called Never Again. Following the Holocaust has become a slogan. How do you ensure never again, the guarantee of never again? The Truth Commission said it was through documentation, that when people know the truth, that will be the never again. And so the Truth Commission precedes the trials, and they meet for close to a year, and they produce a report, and it was written by a literary figure. The head of the commission is Ernesto Sabato, a very well-known writer. And the path to the commission was also paved by civil society, which were these mothers and very fearless NGO actors who demanded the truth, because it wasn't just about the disappearance, it was the ongoing cover-up. And their argument was the crime still exists, even under the successor regime, because it has been denial after denial and cover-up. And we'll see that now, after decades, we now talk about a duty to document, to investigation, and duties of accountability. And civil society, even going way back then to the 80s, has started to shape the ongoing state responsibility. Not just state responsibility for the first crime, for the kidnapping and the from long ago, but the ongoing state responsibility for denials and failure to acknowledge what happened during that time, and then ensuring, of course, repair for victims, but also societal duties that relate to society, and also prevention going forward, which I'm sure you, I was here for Professor and Judge Andras Shayo's talk, and in Europe, they also have these rights of documentation and acknowledgement, and this jurisprudence is trans-judging and is a cross-judging set of obligations. But really, in Latin America, the court cut their teeth on this, and an Inter-American Court of Human Rights, which we'll talk about in just a second. So basically, the Truth Commission report, the essence of its report was it showed the lies of the state. The state had said that there was a dirty war and that the enemy was armed guerrilla, and the report showed that by far the majority of victims were unarmed citizens, students, most of them high school and college. And you can show through forensic evidence how people are killed, and in fact the team, the leading forensic human rights team, came out of Argentina, and they are interdisciplinary psychiatrists, lawyers, doctors, and they anthropologists, and they can show from finding some of these bodies where, you know, and how who the victims are. In any event, what they showed that the story is different. It's a recharacterization of the facts. Instead of an enemy, an armed enemy, it's a citizen, and they show the government cover up as well. So this was really remarkable, and the state had also denied the numbers of those who were assumed missing and dead, and the Truth Commission showed that it was 10,000. The modest figure is 3,000, but the figure that most human rights groups go, it's a very significant number of, if you think about it, of the state taking students and lawyers who are missing and dead. So this is what happened. That Truth Commission allowed for the prosecutions. So think about it. It wasn't the South Africa model. It was an open-ended Truth Commission that led to trials. They said they gave the list to the courthouse, okay? The first part was published. The second part was a confidential annex because you have to worry about due process, and it went to the courthouse. And that is the story of how those national trials could occur. That was a rare open-ended truth commission in Latin America. In Chile, it was like South Africa. In fact, Chile precedes South Africa. It becomes one of the first truth and reconciliation commissions. In Chile, you didn't have the appetite and you didn't have the support. The military were stronger. You couldn't have the trials that Argentina was able to have. Now these are all being revisited because there's a concern in Chile. There's revisionism, unfortunately. There's nostalgia for generals, for the military, and I think the civil society is quite concerned about the absence of a consolidated truth and of adequate change in the structures in the country. So I'll go on. So let me go on to the next example. So up till now, what we've seen is a commitment to truth in transitional democracies, and whether through trials or commissions, and exposure of the truth. Mm. And I was in Argentina after the trials, and it was fascinating. People were following them on radios. The newspapers published accounts every day. So truth can just stay in a government office, or it can actually be disseminated, and there can be outreach. And this is a very important stage that civil society can be involved in. And I think that's something to think about here going forward as well. The importance of a functioning, independent journalistic, bar and journalist and media, and you're living in a time of internet, right? Instagrams, Facebook, Twitter, digital practices that allow for a much more significant approach to these documents. Now, what I want to share with you is an example that is less well known, which is an example of civil society operating without the state. Without support of the state. Because up till now, I've discussed examples of civil society producing documentation and working with either a state court or with a state-run commission, okay? Or an international court. But what do you do if there is no transition yet, right? And I think this could be of interest here. Now you have some change, but it is really the story of for many in who are living in repressive situation still. And one incredible and really remarkable story is from Brazil. So during this bad period in Latin America, Brazil, the military was still fairly strong, and you had the military basically controlling, and they had abductions and torture just like in Argentina and in Chile. How to document it? The state denying it, okay? And in Brazil, this is still a live issue. The state has continued to debate amnesty, even though much of Latin America, because of the rulings of the Inter-American Court of Human Rights, has gone back to have trials. In Brazil, this is still a highly contentious issue. So how did they do it? How do you do this kind of work in the absence of any state cooperation? Well, 283 tortures, 444 torturers, mostly military, although a few were doctors, very shameful. 1,461 men and 382 women had the courage to denounce their mistreatment in military courts. The majority, about 1,000, were under 30. The height of the torture was in between 69 and 1970. So these chilling statistics are central to the book Brazil, Nunca Mais, which is the Portuguese for never again. And what happened was it appeared in bookstores in the midst of the repression, July 1985. It was written and published in secret, became an immediate bestseller, and that's how the military learned that a handful of lawyers had checked out every single case where people had made claims, and they checked them out, and they photocopied them overnight and returned them the next day, and the book was published. Now, what was the essence of it? Why would people believe it and not think of it as false news? It followed the form of the reports. And I think this is very interesting, is that civil society by now in Latin America, the reports have a certain form. They're not sensational. They show a pattern of systemic persecution. They can, you know, name names when it's possible, but these are very carefully produced reports. And that's, you know, why they took the name as well, Never Again. They wanted to follow the Argentine report, and everyone understood. So this is the shadow commission, the one-night commission of these lawyers and the shadow report that was produced, okay? And shadow or no shadow, everyone understood what it was, and it got the facts into the public, and that was really the point. And it was a scandal. How did they do it? The civil society support was, of course, the lawyers, but also the church. The church there was an enterprise, a Presbyterian minister, and he also worked with the Catholic cardinal. And it just so happened that that was a liberal church that was able to help. Unfortunately, that hasn't always been the case. The clergy in Latin America, it varies. In Central America, they tended to be more progressive. But in my home country of Argentina, unfortunately, the church cooperated with the military. And if you made a confession, you would find yourself abducted the next day. And it's a very Opus Dei in Argentina. Now, that is an incredible, I think, a story. And I think what it tells us is that just through those civil society actors, they produced a counter-narrative. It immediately undermined the statements being made by the state of not lack of knowledge. It showed this. In and of itself, it was a performance of political freedoms that people were seeking. The political freedoms of truth-seeking, of expression, freedom of expression, but also accountability. The accountability that we all seek, you know, we ask the state to produce it, but at the end of the day, as I've shown, even state-produced trials and multilateral tribunals have relied consistently on the documentation produced by civil society. And of course, it makes sense. You can't run a trial in a couple of months without this underlying documentation. So what's great, and I've mentioned, is that civil society in those years, the 80s in Latin America, not only were they functioning in this way in the courts and in the truth commissions, but they also, when it wasn't possible to get accountability at home, and in Brazil is a very exceptional case, right, of fighting and opposition. You know, people really were heroes. They risked their lives, right, to do that. There were utter failures other places, like in Honduras and so on. And what do victims do? They go to the Inter-American Court of Human Rights. And so far, you know, and I know you heard about the European Court, and there are, of course, places now where there's repression in Europe that are, you know, the court is hearing is like Hungary and Poland, some level of repression. There were cases involving detentions in the former satellites. But here, that became an expertise of the Inter-American Court of Human Rights. And the first contentious case comes out of Honduras, and it becomes, I would say, it's the Marbury v. Madison for human rights law. Velasquez Rodriguez in the Inter-American Court of Human Rights, which came out of these detentions and disappearances in Honduras, for decades, you know, there was no action. Victims took to the street. They went to Costa Rica, and some of them went to Spain and demanded universality jurisdiction. So if they couldn't get anything, and of course, most of those victims were dead, but it was their representatives or their next of kin that cared enough to go and demand action. And that first case, and really it's a remarkable case, Velasquez Rodriguez is where we see how the interaction is of what we call now transitional justice, but this justice seeking during periods of political regime change or repression, and human rights law. And the court, the Inter-American Court at that time, they didn't just say that, they said that the state had a duty to prevent this kind of crime, right? It makes sense. It's fairly fundamental. It's the social contract that we all believe in, that the state is supposed to take care of us. But as we know, in many parts of the world, that doesn't happen. And when that contract is broken, what happens then? What other rights kick in? And the court finds rights to investigation, rights to truth, rights to prosecution, which is, you know, tricky, and rights to repair for the victim and also to prevent for the future against recurrence. Now, what was really central in this case is that they concluded that the disappearance, the absence of a body, the lack of knowledge, in a way was worse and created more duties because they found that this was a multiple and ongoing violation. That a disappearance is a multiple, a complex violation. It involved more than one article of the American Convention of Human Rights, because we're talking about rights to life, but we're talking about other rights as well, against arbitrary arrest, et cetera, et cetera. And they said it's ongoing until this state, and that could be the successor regime 20 years later, until they acknowledge this, that there is no, that duty has not been addressed, okay? There's been no vindication of victims' rights. So, of course, we're not talking, it's complex, it's difficult. Civil society was involved in two stages as petitioners, both before the commission. There's a rights commission in Inter-American system, which is different than other systems. And there's also the court, the Inter-American Court of Human Rights. And they, I would say that they reconceived the meaning of both truth and justice in that case. It's a really remarkable case to teach and to reread. And if you haven't read it, I would really urge you to do that. So after that case, people start talking in a different way. They start talking about almost a right to accountability. Some people even talk about a right to transitional justice. It's problematic, right? Because we're talking about very complex concepts and so forth. But at minimum, this idea that a state successor regime has to investigate when there's a claim that a citizen has been disappeared, that they need to investigate and either acknowledge and in some way make repair to this next of kin or show a different story. What we now see, and this is, I think, a very fundamental thing that civil society really has given us, this legacy. They've really shaped the law here. The, you know, we often think that states produce law, and in some ways, sure, lawmakers write, you know, legislate and vote on laws, and sometimes there are executive decrees, but really, this was shaped through case law. And you have a combination by now customary international law on this, on these issues, but think about the number of conventions that have come to become law since then. You have, this has changed the ICC statute, for example. There's the torture convention, which involves certain rights, and so forth. And so there's really been, I would say, a sea change as a result of these cases. Now, these are ongoing. Civil society continues to work in my home country in Argentina because we still don't know. There were abductions. I don't know how many of you know, but there were grandchildren that were taken from those who were killed in jail. And some of them talk about a difficult identity politics. Some of them are being raised by military, and their parents were really activists, and they don't look like their parents. I don't know. Sometimes we all say, well, I hardly relate to my parents, but this is a really huge issue in Argentina. There are websites where people are still working with this material and for many different reasons, both on a personal and collective way. How am I doing on time?
We still have about 5 minutes.
Okay, great. So let me give you one more example and then we'll conclude. The other example of civil society today after tribunal, after international courts, is in the Balkans. As many of you know, there was this, you know, I mentioned earlier in my talk, the tribunal for the former Yugoslavia. And even though the prosecutor, the chief prosecutor, Richard Goldstone, who I gather came here a prior time, they wanted trans-ethnic prosecutions so that people would come away understanding that not just one group committed crimes, and there was almost affirmative action in the way of ethno-conscious, even though all of that happened, right? And there were trials of Serbs, trials of Croats, etc. Still, there's a lot of denial in the region, okay? I've been to the region many times, and I'm going again in the fall. So what to do? And what's interesting is civil society, after 25 years, you have a quarter century of international litigation, they have organized a transpartisan, trans-ethnic organization, RECOM. And I think it might be of interest here, RECOM. I put the website there so you can easily access it. And they have engaged in consultations region-wide to ask people what they need, what's the truth that they need to know about. And the idea here is that a lasting truth in the region can't depend on a court in The Hague, but really requires consultations and dialogue and documentation on the ground there. And so we'll see how the work of the tribunal now has some people are talking about the afterlife of the tribunal. So again, civil society witnesses helped produce that, but now it's going back to the region and disseminated. It's also being used in trials in the region. So as many of you know, many of the indictments that weren't completed have now been delegated, are now back in the wing, the international wing in the area. So that's, we're seeing examples of official truth. I want to end to conclude with ongoing issues of truth and memory politics. And that is that Not in all regions does having a centralized truth inquiry make sense. Particularly in post-communist bloc, there was a lot of distrust. And we talk about the end of communism in some part of the world, but obviously it's only in some part of the world. And that was, and we talk about the Cold War, but it was actually quite a hot war in Asia. And only now is the United States, President Obama acknowledged our role in military intervention in Vietnam, in Laos, in Hiroshima. He came to the region in 2016. But the question is, people were very skeptical in Eastern Europe about having a truth commission at the end. That's enough. Totalitarianism was about control of all of that. So I think this is really the question. The answer of the transformative project was responding with freedom of expression, with new constitutions that guaranteed freedom of information or sought to protect your own information and get access to your own file, which could be important here as well. Was important in Eastern Germany. All of this has resulted in a lot of interest in the politics of memory, how in an age of Facebook and false news, you are surrounded by information, not all of which is true. You're bombarded, if you will, with information. So it's a much trickier terrain in a way. Nobody's in charge of the truth. Nobody, and maybe you wouldn't want them to be in charge of the truth, to have one actor. And so now there's draft guidelines that have come out Latin America, the commission there on memory politics, and they talk about the duties of the state to documentation and to creating archives, protecting archives when there aren't any, and I know that's a very important thing here. There are duties now of the state to protect the archives, and so that's very important, that it shouldn't be a political matter or a partisan matter. It should be a general societal, and then to create sites of memory that are diverse, that are inclusive and transpartisan, and that invite participation, both the victims and the society. So I think I'll end it there. And if there's questions, comments, I'd be delighted. So thank you very much for this opportunity.
Thank you so much, Rudy. I think with Rudy's speech, we are assured and we are convinced that civil society does have a role, and a huge role, from documentation to even try to seek the truth without the help from the state. And then the changing role of the civil society even helped to shape the law till today. And I see a lot of colleagues and learned friends there, and then Rudy and I said we have 5 minutes to invite some comments, questions, reflections from our dear colleagues, dear judges. Okay, there are two. Four. Okay, so I will start with from the, yeah, we'll collect them and then.
Well, thank you very much. Thank you. One of the key words here is civil society documentation. And I just wonder how much you have to do, because you have to withstand the trial court and the use of the concept of a conviction beyond reasonable doubt. I wonder how civil society documentation can work toward that status. Thank you.
Thank you very much for that. I'm Mario Gomez from Sri Lanka. I just want to know, a lot of these transitional justice processes take place in deeply divided societies. And I'm talking from my own experience in Sri Lanka, where the army is still seen as heroes among at least some sections of the population. Do you have any suggestions for how do you manage these deep divisions in society in trying to take forward either trials, truth commissions, or reparation processes?
Thank you very much. First is a reflection to one of the very important point that you mentioned. That is, in terms of the government responsibility or obligation, it's not only about how to dig into the truth, but when there is a denial, rejection, cover up, and with that ongoing process, the government or the state is still under obligation to do something. And I was wondering, to what extent we should shift the focus from the wrongdoing to this rejection, particularly when we see these transitional justice issues has gone generations to generation. So I'm a little bit worried about some of the issues that have, you know, it tests our limit of memory and also the politics of time. So this is something that I pretty much worry about. I wonder whether you have any further thought about this.
Yeah, thank you. My question is related to the first one. What happens when there are truths that are not legible on the official register because, for example, of things like requiring proof beyond reasonable doubt, or when you go to an international court, the limits of the jurisdiction of that court? Does it serve to delegitimize what might otherwise be factual truth? Is there a danger here as well that one should be cognizant of?
There is a risk, right? If the work is not up to the standard, and this became an issue in a handful of cases. I remember in the International Criminal Tribunal for the former Yugoslavia, people were working in difficult situations, right, on battlefields and so on. But I think at the end of the day, human rights groups have adjusted, at least the ones that have the resources to be able to do this work. I think it's interesting, in El Salvador, that's one of the few truth commissions that actually announced their standard, that took that question seriously. So I think this is important, because it means that truth commissions need to be self-conscious about the standards, and I think that is all to the good, because the stronger the evidence and the more attention there is to this, the more long-lasting the legacy of that report will be. But I take your point, and I don't think that all cases are ones where civil society can cooperate or help, and there are situations where they may be in a better position to do that than others. And that's true of in general. Prosecutors have discretion in general. I mean, in my country, so you don't bring a case if you don't have adequate facts. And so, you know, it wouldn't be a good idea, period, right, for prosecutors to bring cases where there are shaky facts, right? In fact, even in the former Yugoslavia, the court, this was something that was taken up by the prosecutor. He, you know, they said we can't bring cases where and And if you think about it, why did they start with a low-level paramilitary? They didn't have custody over the leaders. So none of this is, it's not ideal justice, as I write in my book, and very often goes in directions and in an order that doesn't seem, is not a rational order, right? You go where you have evidence and you have custody. And this was something that was repeated by Luis Moreno about in the ICC as well, that people were making demands. Well, it's the role of the prosecutor working with civil society where possible to make those decisions. And maybe civil society can be helpful in shaping those decisions, but again, evidence is important. Just to move along, the Sri Lanka question, I think was the next one. And I would like to learn from you. I know that Sri Lanka was controversial for this, the divided society, the results of investigations. And I know that this is an issue here. And I can only answer with a question, which is that what are your plans to make sure that this becomes a nonpartisan response? And part of it would be consultations, being very open and transparent and with consultations, and being seen not to be acting in a partisan way, but rather acting based on the facts and so forth. But the other is to be modest in step by step, so that, not everything will be can be responded to. Stuff that happened in the past, very unlikely to be talking about prosecutions. But it is very important because we're talking about the future and changing structures and prevention and moving to a more open society and more democratic order. I guess that's the question, is what is the goal? The goal is not to produce a report, right? The goal is to have more consensus and shared understanding of what a democracy is. These are questions. What is your primary goal? And if it is to move from a closed society controlled by security to move to a more open one, or as one goal, then that shapes the interaction. But I think this is a very important question right now, the divided society. And the counter-narrative, that was the next question, was this counter-narrative. And I totally agree. I think that was the point of my talk, really, is that it has shifted the focus from just focusing on the original crimes. And if you think about it, those crimes occurred a long time ago. Yes, the victims need to be repaired, but there is a much more significant and broader societal issue if the state gets away with non-acknowledging torture and disappearances. And now I met the current rapporteur on transitional justice, who's a lovely person. You may want to invite him, also from Argentina. We seem to have over interest and expertise in the issue, Fabian Salvioli. And he talks about memory politics as being critical to prevention. And he wants to add that memory as a duty to memory as a fifth pillar. So he's not just talking about truth. He's talking about how the sites of memory, the documentation, he's talking about that as a fifth pillar. And that's his plan for the next year. So I think there's something to this. So thank you for these great questions and for the opportunity. Yeah.
Thank you. Thank you so much. And then I want to sort of inform the audience Ruti's last night experiences. She was surprised. I was surprised too. But I think it's a great news to Taiwan. So the large audience, the crowd who are mostly interested in her book on transitional justice was the audience aging around 22. So that says something about a bright future of Taiwan. They brought a book, they read the book. They have a lot of questions to ask about Ruti, although our government unfortunately still has not yet issued any official report on the tragedy occurred in 1947, and also those years during our white terror when the martial law decree was imposed. But nevertheless, those under 22 have no experience of any of that. But they all came to Ruti's talk last night. With that, shall you join me again with a big round of applause? Thank you, Ruti, for coming to join us. Thank you. I think we have a break, and then we have the next workshop.
Ladies and gentlemen, we'll have a short break of 5 minutes so the staff can rearrange the seats. Please come back after 5 minutes. Thank you. and gentlemen, let's welcome Professor Li Nianzu, Suzhou University School of Law.
Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. This is the first of two discussion sessions in the afternoon. The subject for this session is torture, death penalty, body integrity, and due process. This will be a timely discussion, particularly after the simulation, which focus upon many issues, including torture, due process, death penalty, and also death penalty is a old topic, but never too old, and it becomes more urgent, particularly several days ago. We all learned that in the United States, the federal government announced that the capital punishment will be resumed in the coming December and January. That would make this session, I believe, more relevant. In the interest of time, I think we better start the discussions. We have three papers with three distinguished speakers invited. Let me briefly introduce them to you. First, Professor Kim Chung Chu from the Republic of Korea School of Law, Yonsei University. And his topic, he has decided to give us a different topic that's exactly the same topic of this session, torture, bodily integrity, death penalty, and due process in the Republic of Korea. That will be a report of the or update of the issues in South Korea. And then we have Mr. Mario Gomez, who is from Sri Lanka, Executive Director at the International Center for Ethnic Studies. His topic was death penalty in Sri Lanka, hanging by a thread. The third speaker will be Professor Tan Xing Li, Singapore, from Singapore, Law School, National University of Singapore, and her topic will be reflections on how the Singapore courts deal with the issues of torture and death penalty, bodily integrity, and due process. We are a little bit behind, I would suggest that each speaker will use 15 minutes and then we can have perhaps another 10 minutes for the floor discussions. Perhaps we start from Professor Kim. Applause, please.
Thank you, moderator. I'm Jongchul Kim, as introduced. It is a great honor to have an opportunity to deliver my own opinion as well as a report about the raised issues in the context of the Republic of Korea. Actually, I've learned a lot from the Asian Court Human Rights Court simulation lasting a couple of days until this morning, and the subjects raised in the simulation have a great influence on the development in this field. across the borders of Asian countries, and definitely will develop and contribute also to the development of human rights law in the globe. I feel nowadays human rights lawyers and scholars are facing two overlapping trends, which is also we encountered in our simulation. On the one hand, international human rights are becoming constitutionalized more and more, and therefore the issue of incorporation of international human rights norms into domestic law draws more attention from constitutional lawyers and scholars, although the topic itself is rather old for international lawyers. From the domestic legal perspective, the issue of how to harmonize international norms and a constitution-based legal system is becoming an urgent matter, especially in the judicial process at the domestic level. On the other hand, the mandate of the protection of human rights or constitutional rights tends to go beyond the border of a nation state, and this internationalization of human rights provides another forum for human rights lawyers to consider international norms in the context of domestic circumstances. This crossroad of internationalization of human rights, as well as the constitutionalization of international human rights, was exactly the background under which the international or regional human rights court have to perform its own role. Not at the moment. At the moment, it's just a simulation. But in the future, hopefully, as a real court with a binding force for the member states as well as the civil society across the Asia. My presentation will cover the second trend. The national situation, which will definitely provide important background and the resources. It's one pillar of the regional or international human rights court. Although the regional or international human rights court is working at the level of international or regional level, without considering the domestic legal system and the socio-economic and the political backgrounds of the legal system, as well as the society, or even the history, or the society as a whole. For example, as we heard from the keynote speech about in transitional justice, without that kind of memory politics sort of thing, we cannot be successful to build a regional human rights court. So this session would be very important opportunity for us to peel the first pillar of regional human rights court. Definitely my report is focused on the South Korean situation. So let me briefly move on to the my main research. Regarding bodily integrity and the death penalty in South Korea, in terms of the constitutional regime, the right to life and the right to bodily integrity is the directly related human rights. But unfortunately, in the constitution of South Korea, they are not enumerated. But we don't have to be disappointed, because although it's not enumerated, they are judicially and politically recognized as inviolable fundamental human rights, entrenched in Article 10 of the Korean Constitution in general and as an enumerated but constitutional rights that are the basis and the precondition of a personal liberty entrenched in Article 12 in particular. It means, you know, in Korean context, Article 12, which embodies personal liberty or the freedom of personal liberty, can be used as the main forces, which is related to important international human rights covenants like ICCPR, as well as CAT, C-A-T. I think you better look at my handouts, which I believe distributed before. I will skip the basic structure of the Article 12 of the Korean South Korean Constitution, but just highlight one of the key sections. The first section of Article 12 entrenches the principles of nulla poena sine lege, and which is most importantly, the due process of law. Due process of law, as you understood, has an Anglo-American constitutional history, it is also influenced new democracies like South Korea. So in 1987, we have a new constitution in the wake of the 1987 People's Uprising, and we introduced the due process of law clause into the Article 12, which entrenches personal liberty in Korea. And the Korean Constitutional Court construed this introduction as introduction of the general principle which governs all the state powers denied to any endeavors to confine its use only for the personal liberties. This is a very important point. And the second section of Article 12 mentioned the prohibition of torture and also self-incrimination, which is directly related to the Cho cases, which was dealt with before the Asian Human Rights Court simulation until today. And let me move on. Article Section 7 of the Article 12 prescribes exactly very concrete principles regarding the bodily integrity and torture. Let me cite, quote, in a case of where compassion is deemed to have been made against a defendant's will due to torture, violence, intimidation, unduly prolonged arrest, deceit, or etc., or in a case where a confession is the only evidence against a defendant in a formal trial, such a confession shall not be admitted as evidence of guilt, nor shall a defendant be punished by reason of such a confession. So it's a denial of the admissibility of the forced confession. So even in the Constitution itself, there is the denial of the admissibility of the forced confession is prescribed. So this is, if the Taiwanese constitution have a similar constitutional provision, then I don't think that there would have been a Chizhou case we don't have to deal with that case. in the simulation. Anyway, let me add this. This principle is exactly reiterated in Articles 309 and 310 of the Criminal Procedure Act. It means, you know, in Korea, as far as the forced confession is concerned, there is no room for the courts or any law enforcement agent to use in the judicial process. Let me move on to the incorporation of international human rights law into Korean legal system. Oh, I have already used 12 minutes. Yeah, and then I will focus on the main topics of the my presentation. We have Article 6, which provides that the international law, including you know customary international law, or can be incorporated directly into the Korean legal system. So it means international laws can be used as the references of the decisions at the domestic level. But unfortunately, so far, Korean ordinary courts as well as constitutional court was very reluctant to use it for many reasons, I think. But one of the reasons, if I may say, is their ignorance, their lack of knowledge of the international laws. That's my personal understanding, but I think it's true. Anyway, I am quite unfortunate to report to you, although we have a clear provision of the Constitution, we are so far very reluctant to incorporate international human rights law into domestic level. Let me move on to CAT. Regarding CAT, one point needs to be noted. UN Committee Against the Torture, as the treaty monitoring body of CAT, has expressed its concerns so far three times regarding South Korean case, mainly focused on the incorporation of a specific definition of the crime of torture in Korean penal legislation. As I mentioned, the torture itself is a prescribed reason to deny or exclude from the you know evidence because of it is the absolute reason of the you know forced confession, but this UN Committee Against Torture sees this is not enough. So Korean government and legislature must have a new law or need to you know amend the penal law or criminal procedure act whatsoever to define the crime of torture according to CAT. That is their recommendation. And regarding death penalty, we have so far two constitutional review cases. Unfortunately, it is not declared unconstitutional. Mainly because in Korea, exactly you know 110 section 4 of the Korean Constitution mention death penalty. Of course, it is not mentioned as a you know. A way of you know criminalization or a criminal penalty, but to secure the accused right not to be sentenced to death penalty, but it's you know enumeration or elaboration or just the stipulation of the death penalty. The word itself can give, you know, constitutional justices some clue or some rationale or background not to declare the death penalty as unconstitutional, because the Constitution itself preconditioned or presumed the existence of death penalty as a sort of a criminal penalty. Yeah, that is one of the main reasons of the majority opinion of the Constitutional Court dealing with the death penalty legislation. Please give me one more minute only. Let me move on to the due process. As I mentioned, you know, in 1987, constitutional amendment introduced the due process of law clause, and that according to Korean Constitutional Court, this is a general constitutional principle governing all the activities of the state powers. So it can cover not only the judicial process, but also legislative and the administrative process as well. And the Constitutional Court regarded this principle as the general principle. So the context of this principle in the Constitution, I mean, it is located in the Article 12 and the Section 1, which embodies which safeguards the personal liberty only, but it is construed not to confine to the personal liberty, but all the constitutional liberties and the human rights. That is very important. And also, the Article 12 elaborates a lot of specific rights, for example, the Miranda rules sort of thing, and including, you know, denial of the self-incrimination. The accused have the constitutional right to be silent on the cases. That sort of thing is articulated exactly in the Article 12. But the Constitutional Court regarded these safeguards, constitutional safeguards, as exemplary. So it means it can be used, this kind of, you know, specific rights and rules, can be used not only in the judicial process, but also administrative processes. So, for example, this, recently, Supreme Court of Korea used this due process of law clause as the, you know, background to strike down the administrative actions to levy a tax, even though there is no statutory provision at all. And also, from this perspective or understanding of the judicial due process of law, fair trial, the right to fair trial can be one of the, you know, rights covered by the due process of law. But in Korea, we have a specific constitutional provision which is envisaged to protect the free trial. So under this background, Korean Criminal Procedure Act stipulates reasons of recusal of judges in very detail. So let me just finish by citing the last one, which is related to our Jisho case, where she or he or she is a judge, has participated in the decision by the court below, or investigation or trial which constituted the basis thereof in the case, should be excluded. So if Taiwan has this kind of exclusionary rule, then you know, Chijo should be, sentenced not guilty, only on this account. Thank you.
Thank you, Professor Kim. Sorry. Very good suggestions. Next, let's move to Mr. Gomez on the Sri Lanka. review.
Thank you. Okay. Yeah, thank you very much, Professor Lee. It's a pleasure to be on this panel with Professors Kim and Sian Lee. Since 2007, the UN General Assembly has been passing a number of resolutions on the death penalty. Many of these resolutions have urged states that have abolished the death penalty to make sure that the abolition stays in place. And those that have, as a matter of practice, not enforced the death penalty to ensure that this moratorium stays in place. It has also urged states through these several General Assembly resolutions to ensure that those who are sentenced to death have a chance to appeal against the sentence in a transparent and open manner. The General Assembly resolutions have also called upon states to sign the second optional protocol to the ICCPR, and then ask states to disaggregate information on the use of the death penalty by sex, age, and race. So the most recent of these resolutions was in December 2018, when about 120 states signed on to this resolution against the death penalty. Sri Lanka was one of them. It had also in 2016 similarly signed a resolution as well, even though on previous occasions it had abstained from signing on to these resolutions. Now, the death penalty remains part of the Sri Lankan legal regime. For murder in Sri Lanka, it is compulsory. The High Court judge, a trial court judge, has no discretion in terms of imposing that sentence. In 1984, we had an amendment to the ordinance to the law that regulates drugs and drug trafficking, and the death sentence was imposed or integrated or brought in as an amendment and gave the trial judge the right to sentence somebody to death for the trafficking of drugs. There have been some moves to abolish the death penalty in Sri Lanka. So in the 1950s, it was abolished briefly for about 3 years. Then we had an assassination of a prime minister, and the death penalty was brought back again. But even though we've had the death penalty on our statute books theoretically, no one has been executed since 1976. So for 43 years, successive presidents have commuted the death penalty to life imprisonment. In June last year, the president of the country suddenly announced that he wanted to re-implement and bring back the death penalty, especially for drug-related offenses. In January this year, the president visited the Philippines and sang praises and hallelujahs to the current Filipino president for his crackdown on drug offenders. Then in June this year, the president signed the warrant for the execution of 4 prisoners on death row, 3 men and 1 woman. Now, soon after that, 2 interesting things happened. One was that there were 2 applications filed in the courts challenging the signing of this warrant by the president. One was by a prisoner on death row, arguing that the signing of this warrant infringed his right to equality and equal treatment, and that the execution or the implementation of the death penalty would be a violation of the right against freedom of torture and cruel, inhuman, and degrading treatment. This was followed by a second case in the Court of Appeal that sought a writ of prohibition against the Commissioner of Prisons from executing any people on death row. And one of the arguments of the lawyer in that case was that the law governing the powers of the Commissioner of Prisons did not permit him to execute a prisoner. So it was a very technical argument that there was a legal gap, that all the Commissioner of Prisons had, the power that he had, was just to keep prisoners in custody and make sure that they are looked after. But there was a legal lacuna that did not permit the Commissioner of Prisons to execute somebody. On the 5th of July this year, the Supreme Court granted an interim stay order, suspending executions till the end of October. We have a presidential election coming up by December.
And many of us hope that the election will be used as a way of actually suspending any further executions. In January 2016, there was a very powerful statement from the Human Rights Commission of Sri Lanka, urging the president not to reinstate the death penalty and arguing that even though the right to life is not explicitly part of Sri Lanka's constitution, that it's a violation of the right to equality and it amounts to cruel, inhuman, and degrading treatment. Now, the second interesting thing that happened this year was that in July, soon after the president signed these warrants for the execution of four people on death row, was a private member's bill that was tabled in Parliament. And what the private member's bill attempts to do is to abolish the use of the punishment of death penalty in all Sri Lanka's laws and to substitute life imprisonment for that. Those prisoners or those people who are facing trial and have not been convicted as yet, should they be convicted, would also face life imprisonment and not the death penalty. And similarly, it tries to have retrospective effect by arguing that all those people who have been convicted to the sentence of death shall instead suffer the sentence of life imprisonment and not death. This bill has been tabled in Parliament. It has not yet been debated. And many of us in Sri Lanka, of course, hope that Parliament will take it up and pass this law. Now, I think this move on the death penalty in Sri Lanka has also to be looked at in the context of global developments. So there's been this huge momentum against the death penalty over the years. I think in the 1960s, there were only about 25 countries that had abolished the death penalty. Now I think it's well over 100, 120 countries if you take those states that have also abolished it as a matter of practice. And I think this momentum has also been created by the UN, by its resolution since 2007, by the second optional protocol to the ICCPR, by protocols at the European court level, at the inter-American level, and also lots of jurisprudence from national courts that have argued and held, really, that the death penalty is unconstitutional. We have the famous celebrated South African case, but then we have jurisprudence from India, which has argued that the mandatory death penalty is unconstitutional. Tanzania and many other courts of the world have contributed to this growing momentum against the death penalty globally. I think you all must be familiar with Article 6 of the ICCPR, which says that the death penalty can be imposed. But we have a very interesting general comment number 36 of the UN Human Rights Committee, which was adopted last year, and which I hope actually Council earlier on had referred to more often. But the sort of general comment argues that the death penalty should apply only to the most serious crimes, and drug offenses, sexual offenses, economic crimes, armed robbery, political crimes do not constitute the most serious offenses. So it also argues that mandatory death sentences are illegal and against international norms. So assessed against the framework articulated by the Human Rights Committee in General Comment number 36, Sri Lanka's legal provisions clearly would violate international norms because there is mandatory death sentencing, and the death sentence also applies for drug-related offenses. Now, I think what has happened over the years globally is that the whole idea of the sanctity of life has emerged really to trump what is now seen as an outmoded and ancient type of punishment. Sentencing policy has shifted from a focus on punishment and retribution to rehabilitation and reform. As Chief Justice of South Africa argued many years ago, retribution cannot be accorded the same weight under our constitution as the right to life and dignity. I think questions of fabrication of evidence, that trials were manipulated by the police, the fact that the death penalty cannot be reversed,
that it is really the economically disadvantaged and the poor who perhaps are susceptible to the death penalty have been some of the arguments that have been raised against the death penalty and this sort of growing momentum against the death penalty globally. Now, in Sri Lanka, there have been many moves to revive the death penalty. So about 10 years ago, there was a murder of a high court judge. There was a gruesome murder of a young girl in Jaffna, a rape and a murder. And there was a public outcry and public outrage that the death penalty should be reimposed. But thankfully, the president at that time did not implement the death penalty. And now you have a president whose political fortunes are on the wane, who is trying to use the death penalty to bolster his political fortunes. What is different today, I think, is that public opinion in Sri Lanka has shifted. There isn't that large degree of public support for the death penalty as there was 10 years ago. And so I think Sri Lanka may really be on the verge of a historic moment that we might be able to legally get rid of the death penalty, either by way of this private member's bill, if Parliament adopts it, or through judicial interpretation, should the Supreme Court take the matter up at the end of this year, and find that the implementation of the death penalty amounts to cruel, inhuman, and degrading treatment. So just to conclude, we have the political aspirations of the president. His political popularity is on the wane. He would like to be re-elected in December. He sees the death penalty as one way of growing electoral support and public support for his electoral campaign. But he's obviously picked the wrong issue to try and show up some public support. And paradoxically, this is a story of a political leader trying to use the death penalty to support his re-election chances. But he's obviously read the public pulse wrong. And there hasn't been that degree of public support for the reinstatement of the death penalty. And on the other hand, what his actions may really have done in Sri Lanka is to enable Parliament and possibly the courts to declare the death penalty unconstitutional and illegal. So I'll end my presentation there. Thank you, Professor Lee.
Thank you very much, Mr. Gomez. You have described very similar situations. We should all give a serious thought. Next, we should turn to Professor Tan. Yes.
Good afternoon, everybody. So today I'm going to also share my experience, Singapore's experience of torture, death penalty, bodily integrity, and due process. So because Singapore is such a small country, I have distilled the concept so that it will be relatable to everyone in the room, whether you're an NGO activist, whether you're a scholar, or whether you are a student. Right, and no matter what jurisdiction you come from, Singapore is a common law country, but I guess the legal principles could also be translated to your own jurisdiction, whether civil or common law. So, you know, in the trial simulation, we talked about international law principles, especially by the counsel for Mr. Xiu, and domestic law principles like the real risk test, by the counsel for Mr. Liu. So Singapore is a very good example to show where international law comes into the national jurisdiction and how these are interpreted, accepted first, interpreted, and then applied, right? So I think we're in a very fortunate position. Singapore is very conservative, but increasingly, we are more open to international law. So before, when I was a girl, when I was a child growing up, international law was, you know, strictly four walls principle. International law does not come into the Singapore domain because we're a common law system, we're a dualist system. Only Singapore law applies to Singapore. Now, we are being more progressive. International law is becoming more applicable to Singapore as a whole, and therefore into our courts. and you will see how international law principles may be translated and used by the courts, even if they push out, you know, what the international law standards are, but then at least the courts engage with the international law principles now. So what are we talking about in terms of the principles regarding death penalty and torture and so on and so forth? So, you know, the counsel for Mr. Xiu was going on the point that, you know, torture is prohibited and there is wide acceptance in international law. So, and you can see it's in the UDHR, in the ICCPR, and also in the regional human rights treaties. And then we also have a specific treaty for torture, right? Article 1 of the Torture Convention. What is torture? It involves severe pain and suffering that is intentionally inflicted, and, you know, there must be this public persona, some public official or someone acting in a public official capacity that inflicts such pain, right? And it goes on to say that torture is not, you know, it does not include pain or suffering arising only from or inherent in or incidental to lawful sanctions. So if there is, you know, grievous pain from lawful sanctions, that is not considered torture, right? So this is something very important to remember as we look at domestic law later. And of course, you know, there is an absolute prohibition against torture. So during our trial simulation, there was also the discussion of torture and inhuman punishment. There is a distinction, and it's usually, so torture is different from inhuman punishment, okay? The distinction goes on the degree or severity of pain and also the intention, okay? Different tribunals distinguish them, the degrees differently. In terms of death penalty, so Professor Gomez has already brought up, you know, this is in Article 6 of the ICCPR, right? No one shall be arbitrarily denied of life, right? And then there is a specific, explicit expression on the death penalty. In countries which have not abolished the death penalty, which is Singapore, right, included in this, right, the sentence of death may only be imposed for most serious crimes, you know, in accordance with the law in force at the time of the commission, right? And then in 2018, what did the Human Rights Committee say? So these crimes of extreme gravity must involve mens rea, intentional killing, so on and so forth. Drug offences are not included, okay? And we go on to say that, and it goes on to say that states that retain the death penalty must respect Article 7 of the ICCPR, which pertains to torture, cruel, inhuman, and degrading punishment. And the specifications, violations of Article 7, right, down here, what constitutes torture or inhuman degrading punishment, so they can pertain to methods of execution, right? The committee was silent on hanging, so this will pertain to Singapore, right? If you do not inform the convict of timely notification of the execution, if there is extreme delay in the implementation of the death sentence, if we think of Mr. Xiu, 31 years, right, coming in 31 years, all these are possible violations of Article 7. So now let's look at Singapore. Singapore, well, you know, government, three branches, right? The executive, the court, and the legislature. So the Singapore's perspective or the outward expression on, you know, death penalty and torture. So what the government, and usually through the mouthpiece of the foreign ministry, Singapore has always expressed that it is against torture. Singapore does not conduct torture or any form of, you know, torturous punishment, okay? But Singapore retains a very conservative outlook and practice in terms of, if you compare it to international law principles. And Singapore, in its conservative, or if we are very liberal, we see Singapore as very conservative, and how it's conservative is because Singapore has for a very long time maintained the capital punishment and corporal punishment. So what how do we conduct our capital punishment? It's by hanging. And I bolded hanging there because now counsel have come into the court and presented hanging as not only, you know, it is, you know, the mandatory death penalty is wrong, but it's also mandatory death penalty is torture, right? So it cuts both ways. And also corporal punishment, we do it by caning, and that has also been contested as torture. Now, apart from the foreign ministry's public expression, we have actually pushed back against the UN. So the 2012 Special Rapporteur on Torture, Singapore has come up to say, we are against torture, we have worked with the international community, and Singapore society, including citizens like me, we do not condone torture, right? And then it goes on to say, not only society, not only government, not only our laws, but, and not only our international friends, but the Singapore legislation prohibits harm with criminal intent. So we look back at what, you know, torture means. You need to have that intention. And it also goes on to say that national security agencies like our police, our army, right? We have strict codes, we have strict laws on official conduct. So security personnel cannot abduct, there cannot be disappearances, cannot be torture. Okay? And I bolded the fourth paragraph, no international consensus that there is that the death penalty, when applied in accordance with the due process of law and judicial safeguards in Singapore, violates the prohibition against torture and cruel and inhuman punishment. So that paragraph, Singapore repeats verbatim at every international forum where it's questioned on torture and cruel and inhuman punishment. Okay? And Singapore maintains its sovereignty, that every country has the sovereign right to decide on its own criminal justice procedure and punishment. Now, just only this year, it has come up to say again, the connection between the death penalty and torture is tenuous, right? To the UN Human Rights Council in February, so again, it's the same paragraph, no international consensus that the death penalty is torture. Now, that's the executive stand. What do our courts think? So the Singapore government, three branches of government, it is widely known that they come up to say that there is a harmonious relationship, right, between the three branches of government. And so how do the courts apply? So we are not like how Professor Kim has outlined that, you know, the Korean law is very detailed, very specific. In Singapore, torture, death penalty just comes under Article 9 of the Singapore Constitution, right? No person shall be deprived of his life or personal liberty save in accordance with the law. And then I highlight four principles that, you know, we might want to carry through as I finish up my slides, right? The courts always say, penalties are meted out after due process. So it's not willy-nilly. We actually go through the technical detail of the law. We uphold legality, legitimacy, due process. Okay? And what they have found after due process is that death penalty and caning, you know, do not violate our constitutional provision of Article 9. And it also, in justifying its stand, vis-a-vis international law, it says that Singapore is dualist and we have a four walls doctrine. So domestic law takes precedence over international law. And then generally, there would be deference to parliament regarding lawmaking and policy considerations regarding, you know, criminal justice, criminal law, you know, making of criminal law. So how has the courts, how do the courts mirror what the executive has said? So Singapore is against torture. This has come out repeatedly in the case law on where torture or death penalty in relation to torture has come up. And then this has also been reflected in the arguments about Singapore's legal history, our lawmaking, our legislation, and our constitution, because there was a lawyer in 2010 which said that, we should read the provision the prohibition against cruel and inhuman punishment into the Singapore Constitution of Article 9. And then the Chief Justice said, no, we cannot read that into that provision because at the time of Singapore's independence and drafting of the Constitution, although there was this provision that said that was proposed to put in, you know, a prohibition against cruel and inhuman punishment, the government rejected that inclusion. But nonetheless, the court said, even without that inclusion, which means that we cannot read it literally into Article 9, Singapore is still against torture. But then you can see there's a conflation between torture and inhuman punishment. But it says, you know, the stand is we are against torture. Okay? Right. And then it goes on to say that Singapore courts will see that any repugnancy between Singapore law and the Constitution is invalid. Okay? Then the courts also come up to say that corporal punishment, so caning in Singapore, is not torture, it is also not inhuman punishment. And why is this so? Right? Because this is under our penal system. It goes through a rigorous process. It's only applied to selected crimes. And therefore, this does not amount to torture because only serious crimes incur caning. And because caning is also implemented with strict safeguards. Okay? And lastly, in relation to international law, there is no special stigma of severe and indiscriminate brutality with regard to how caning is carried out in Singapore, and therefore this is not torture. Now, how does the mandatory death penalty, you know, death by hanging, come about, you know, in relation to international law? Again, of course, the courts come up to say it is not torture, it is not inhuman punishment, because it is, again, not arbitrary. It is not disproportionate to the crime, so only the most serious offences can incur the mandatory death penalty. But in Singapore, the death penalty is meted out for murder, and we also have it for drug offences. Okay, so you can see it conflicts on the drug offences part, it conflicts with, you know, what the UN has said, right? And then, so how does the Singapore court then refute this argument regarding drug offences and the death penalty? So they say that the mandatory death penalty under the Misuse of Drugs Act, the primary legislation in Singapore, is discriminating enough to obviate any inhumanity in its operation, and therefore it's constitutional. It didn't explain why in detail this is, you know, there are differentiating factors or criteria, but it says it's differentiating enough, okay? And then if, let's say, if you're a counsel and you want to bring it before the court, right, you bring in principles of international law, customary international law. If you have a very conservative court, which is my perspective of Singapore, but it's becoming more open, but it says, the court will say, there is no consensus that in customary international law that, you know, hanging is a cruel, inhuman, or degrading punishment. Yeah, right? So Singapore court said, no. You think it's customary international law? We don't think so. And there is no consensus on this. Right? Yeah, and then I've talked about that point. Not possible to read into the Singapore Constitution because of our constitutional history. Now, and then where is this deference to the Parliament's purview in making law? Then the courts will also say that the appropriate level of culpability for imposing the mandatory death penalty is within the Parliament's competence as a matter of policy. So the courts say, Parliaments make law, courts only interpret law, and that is our job. Now, then we look at principles of common law. If you're a creative lawyer, you bring in principles of common law and natural justice. Okay. Right, so, and then what is the tune, right? It says that, you know, common law is accepted by Singapore. And, you know, but even if caning falls within the scope of the common law prohibition, statute would take precedence over such a general prohibition. So now that we have statute on, you know, caning and so on and so forth, our statute would take precedence. And lastly, on customary international law, we know what the general customary international law attitude of the Singapore courts is. Let's look at youth cogens, because I think our NGO friends are very, very interested in this. The courts have said that even if youth cogens, our domestic legislation cannot be invalidated due to its incompatibility with international law, right? So even if youth cogens, you know, peremptory norm of international law, Singapore courts will not accept it as such, right? Because the duty of the domestic court, the Singapore court, is to implement the will of parliament embodied in the domestic legislation. So you can see, even if there are progressions in international law, even if the courts have also progressed, but sometimes, or very often, there will be creative takes to maintain, you know, a legal system as what it is, and it's really very difficult to change and to move things forward. Thank you.
Thank you. Before I, our time is has been quite limited. Before I open the floor for questions, I'd like to add 2 points along the line of international norms. The papers refer to the ICCPR Article 6 and 7. I'd like to remind that the last paragraph of Article 7 of ICCPR, it says, nothing in this article shall be invoked to delay or to prevent the abolition of capital punishment by any state party to the present covenant, which means not even the capital punishment for most severe crime paragraph. And further, I'd like to remind 2 provisions. One of ICCPR and one of Universal Declaration of Human Rights, which I consider most relevant. What I would like to say is Article 16 of ICCPR, which says, everyone shall have the right to recognition everywhere as a person before the law. Similar article, this article derives from Article 6 of Universal Declaration of Human Rights, which reads, everyone has the right to recognition everywhere as a person before the law, almost exact the same. These 2 provisions are saying personhood is not deniable anywhere. Everywhere is the key word. Wherever a court announces a death penalty sentence, it denies personhood. It violates this provision. And everywhere execution is done, it denies personhood. It violates these provisions. That's clear cut. And these 2 provisions, I would argue, provide the premises on which the provision, the Article 6 and 7 of ICCPR will be understood correctly without going through all those hassle of what does cruel means, what does it mean by extremely severe punishment. It's illegal per se, period. Now, perhaps we can talk to the, we can open the floor to the questions.
I just have a question for Professor Kim. As you mentioned that in South Korea, there has been no execution since 1997, after December 1997. So I'm curious, or kind of curious about, is there any law scholar argue that it's, no execution is against the law? And second, does the general public push the government to execute the inmates? Because these 2 questions are often happen in Taiwan.
Perhaps we collect three questions. That's one source of question. Three sources of questions. Any? Well,
then questions to be answered by.
Thank you for the questioning that, because I have to rush into the conclusions. I omitted this is a very important part of my presentation, but I'm really grateful to you for having a chance to mention this part. I will elaborate a little bit before answering to the question. At the moment, Korea is very fortunately, as I mentioned, twice the Constitutional Court failed to declare the death penalty as unconstitutional, but since 1987, there was no execution at all. So according to Amnesty International, Korea is abolitionist in practice country. But however, there are still 60 inmates with death sentence. Recently, a prisoner with death penalty passed away naturally a couple of days ago. So it was down from the 61 to 60. It's a very sad story. In last year, 2018, the National Human Rights Commission of South Korea recommended the South Korea government, I mean the relevant departments and the prime minister, should ratify the second optional protocol to ICCPR, aiming at the abolition of the death penalty. So this National Human Rights Commission is part of the South Korean government, which is definitely challenging the other departments. Anyway, it is a government organ, but it is making their effort to abolish it. So that this situation in the between the ideal of abolition of death penalty, as Nigel reminded us of that, and the reality where even the constitution or the penal code itself has death penalty as a criminal punishment. So let me move on to the question to about it's I think it's a fundamental question before us, not only in front of Taiwan but also South Korea. So how can I give you the correct answer? I think we are in the transition period, I believe, from the non-abolitionist and the abolitionist in practice, and finally, I hope in the near future we will get there, abolitionist in practice as well as de jure. Thank you.
Thank you. Ms. Gometz? Okay.
I have a question for both Mario and Professor Tan. I was wondering why in Sri Lanka, suddenly Sirisena, who is a very weak leader, is taking this. Does it mean that former President Rajapaksa camp different in terms of its policy on death penalty? And especially after experiencing such a terrible war in killing, why is it? I really want to hear a little bit more. And for Professor Tan, when was the last time a death penalty sentence was rendered in Singapore?
I have a question for Professor Tan. In Singapore, you just said the judges have said killing is not inhuman cruel punishment. I mean, this fear judges have a right to say. So I mean, the question is how caning has been perceived in the society. Do parents, for example, teachers, I guess they are not allowed to sort of impose corporal punishment against the students, children. So from a society perspective, is caning regarded as sort of a torture, inhuman punishment at a society level, not at a governmental level? Thanks.
So I think President Sirisena came into power in 2015, promising just one term. But of course, like most political leaders, after a taste of power, he decided he wanted a second term. And the whole drug war, I think, was one issue which he thought he could grasp and get hold of, and therefore cultivate public support. But I think he misread public opinion completely. And neither Rajapaksa nor Wickremesinghe, who's prime minister, and the former president Rajapaksa have supported him on the death penalty. No parliamentarians have come out in favor of it. So there's really been no public champion of the death penalty apart from President Sirisena, whose popularity is waning. The only person, ironically, who supported him has been the Catholic Archbishop last year. And this was overruled very soon after by the Vatican, because I don't know whether you remember the 1st August statement from the Vatican saying that the death penalty was now illegal. So there's really been no public champion of the death penalty in Sri Lanka, and therefore there's been no resonance with public opinion. And I just think he's clinging to a straw because he's seeking re-election.
He needs a better political strategy. Terrible, all right?
Sri Lanka.
Well, okay, maybe not. So on the question of the death penalty in Singapore, so this occurs regularly. So we have no moratorium. I think the last one, and usually the lawyers will bring it to, you know, for presidential clemency, pardon and all that. I think it was late last year, or maybe another case earlier this year. I can't remember, because it does happen very regularly. And so, you know, on the human rights blog pages and so on, or in the NGO community, we get updated on this, right? And also some faculty members are also, you know, helping behind the scenes on the legal arguments, so on and so forth. On caning as a societal, yeah, I guess it's a societal norm. When my dad was in school, so my dad is a baby boomer, post-war generation, he said that when he was in school, you had public caning. So for boys, not girls, so the boys would be on the stage, if you committed something wrong, whack. Yeah, and you could choose your cane. Or then maybe if your offense was not so bad, you get called to the principal's office and then you get to choose your cane, right? So now in Singapore, I think caning is a bit frowned upon, but I think in certain schools, and only again, maybe boys' schools, I don't know whether mixed schools have it for the boys, but then I think there is caning. And then I think you have to ask the parents' permission now. Yeah, whereas before, the parents would say, oh, good, you did something wrong. Yeah, you deserve the whack, right? But now, no. And I think in Singapore society, for caning, like the criminal punishment of that is, you know, it has been so much a part of our societal landscape. I think people don't really think that there is very much wrong to it. We don't use it for, we use it for serious crimes, sexual offenses, so on and so forth, armed robbery. And then it's also very open. Whereas the death penalty and there's a mystery surrounding it, it's guarded by the Official Secrets Act of Singapore. So you can't talk about it, or, you know, there is very little information about it. Whereas caning, you know, corporal punishment is very, you know, there's a lot of knowledge. You can Google, yeah? You can even see what it's like. And then if you're a boy at risk, right? So teenager or, yeah, or juvenile delinquent, they will organize these excursions to the prisons for you and then show you what caning is like and what will happen to you if you commit serious offenses. And then, that's...
Thank you. Now it's time to conclude. Thank you for the three speakers for the wonderful presentations and the audience. Thank you.
Ladies and gentlemen, we'll have a short recess of 10 minutes. We'll reconvene at 4:25, thank you. Ladies and gentlemen, let's welcome Professor Ye Junrong from National Taiwan University College of Law.
Well, what a achievement. This is the last session, huh? So we are excited this is the last session, but we are even excited that we have three prominent scholars here with us to present papers of their own country on the topic of the incorporation of human rights, particularly international human rights. We all know that in the past we may see international human rights and domestic human rights are two tracks. They are parallel. But more often, we found that they are converged one way or the other. Maybe in different way, in different area, in different region, with different human rights instruments and implementation, but the convergence of international human rights and domestic human rights, particularly those guaranteed by the state constitution, has been one of the very intriguing topics for the international constitutional lawyers and also practitioners. So with us for this panel are Professor Liao Fu-te. Now you are judge, so I was wondering whether I should call you judge or professor, but I call you Fu-te more often.
Yes.
Okay, Professor Liao Fu-te is with Academia Sinica. He has been advocating and also researching on this issue in Taiwan for quite a long time and has been established his own reputation in this area. So we got the best person to talk about the scenario of this incorporation on Taiwan. And then our second presentation is Judge Pawat. Pawat is going to talk about Thailand's situation and the status quo in terms of the incorporation of international human rights. Professor Pawat is with Chulalongkorn University. And this is also a very important jurisdiction for us to know the implementation and incorporation of international human rights domestically. Last but not least, Judge Aparna Chandra, representing India. She is a professor at National Law University, Delhi. We can see these three jurisdictions may represent different, you know, style and different types of country. We have common law states, and we have like Thailand. Thailand is kind of mixed, right? Well, I would say mixed. With your approval, sometimes I find that Taiwan is also a little bit mixed, but some people will argue that it's a continental legal system. But I would say, to some extent, it's still a little bit mixed, but it's hard to say. Let's begin with Professor Liao. Each of you have 15 minutes. I'm not going to pass, you know, these warnings, and somebody will do the job for me. And I'm happy that we will have a time alert for you. Please observe the time limit so that we can open up the floor discussion in a better way. Let's begin with Professor Liao. Would you please set a good example?
I will try my best.
Okay.
All right. Thank you very much, Chairperson Professor Ye. I think I have a task much easier than the other two speakers because I'm going to talk about the situation in Taiwan, and the most participants here know much well about this situation. So I'll try to
keep it very briefly and within 15 minutes. Okay, the title that I apply is in fact My Way, and the subtitle is Taiwan's Ratification and Incorporation of International Human Rights Treaties. And I guess people of my age, which is middle age, know one very famous song, My Way, very well. Yeah, so at my research academic career for about 20 years, this song is always come to my mind, especially when I am doing research on incorporation of international human rights treaties, because it's a real situation that Taiwan, in fact, is doing its own way and my way of incorporation of international human rights treaties, and then you can find that it's a very unique situations. So I've tried to brief several points on this issue. The first point is about the historical developments of the adventures to international human rights regimes, and in fact, I have the idea that I think it was the common view of the people in Taiwan that it's a situation of isolated state with universal value. So it's a very unique one. But this adventure is quite amazing. It's quite amazing. I'll divide it into three stages. The first stage is between 1945 and 1971. At that time, the Republic of China, the name of Republic of China, is a member of the United Nations and also a permanent member of Security Council. So there was no difficulty to participate in drafting international human rights treaties, including Universal Declaration of Human Rights. But at that time, by the end of 1971, I would say that Taiwan at that time was not really a positive participant, because Taiwan, in the name of Republic of China, tried to participate in drafting every international human rights treaty. But at the same time, the Republic of China only ratified ICRD at that time, in 1970. So I would say that it was not a positive participant. And the second stage is between 1971 and 2000. I would call it double isolation, because in 1971, Taiwan left, or Republic of China left the UN, and became not a member of the United Nations. And on the other hand, international the development of international treaties was not a very common knowledge in Taiwan, no matter its academic field or for the general public. So I would call this double isolation. Because it's a long time double isolation, it's very difficult to bring international human rights treaty into Taiwanese society. But the third stage, I would call after 2000, it's an amazing starting point in 2000. When the former President Chen Shui-bian declared that he wishes to build a state with human rights, like what we call human rights state. So that's a very very important starting point to incorporate international human rights treaties into Taiwan's domestic law. And I guess I should emphasize, because Taiwan has some political developments and changes in different periods of time. We had the first political party turnover in 2000, and the second one in 2008, and the third one in 2016. So in theory, an idea proposed by the former President Chen could be changed by different political party. But it's great that after 2000, even Taiwanese government by the different political party and two major political party, DPP and the KMT, both party agreed on this human rights policy, and it's going on, and there's no return. There is no return, and it's going on. It's still going on. So I think this historical development is quite important to Taiwan for the issue that we have been talking about, incorporation of human rights treaties. And the second point I'd try to make is that maybe we can think about what human rights treaties have been incorporated. And we, as I said, we have gone through different stages. So it is incorporated by different approaches. The first one is that, in fact, the Republic of China ratified ICERD, ICERD, in 1970. So that's the first one, the only one before 1971. And after 2000, we have incorporated several international human rights treaties, including ICCPR, ICESCR, and CEDAW, CRC, and the CRPD. So that's the five major core international human rights treaties that have been incorporated. And so people can understand what haven't been incorporated. They include CAT, C-A-T, ICMW, CPED. There are three. But I have to emphasize that we have been preparing for implementing the acts to incorporate these three core human rights treaties. So we are expecting that at the end of the day, all nine core human rights treaties will be incorporated into Taiwanese domestic law in the near future. I hope so. But there are bills. There are bills try to ratify or implement or incorporate these three treaties that haven't been incorporated. So that's a positive way. That's a positive way that we should be still following on. And the third point that I try to make is that, and what approaches have been adopted to incorporate? And because the history of double isolation in the past of time, in the past in Taiwan, I have to say it's very difficult to incorporate international rights treaty in the past and even now. So what we can find is very unique. We have several approaches. The first one is that, and as I mentioned it, we ratified ICERD in 1970, and there's by far no implementing law, and the government hasn't decided whether we need an implementing law at all. But there's a problem. Not everyone knows that Taiwan has already ratified ICERD in 1970. It happened. It happened in the domestic court. Now, I remember there was one case that some scholars argue that Taiwan even have ratified ICERD in 1970. But the judge replied that, don't say that to me. That's not a point. And I don't know that point. And so don't think that to me. So I think that's a question. That's a question, yeah. And the second approach that has been made is about CEDAW. In fact, we assessed to CEDAW in 2007. But the implementing act was not adopted until 2011. So we have a session first, then comes the implementing act. Yeah, that's a different stage. So that's a problem that between 2007 and 2011, we didn't know whether CEDAW has domestic legal status or not. So, but unfortunately, it was a problem in the past. It's not the problem now. And the third approach is that about ICCPR and ICCR. They had a ratification and implementation law both in 2009 at the same day. So that's in fact a typical approach to adopt. And the fourth approach is that about CRC and the CRPD. We have implementing law first in 2014, but the bill, the law to assess to these two treaties were not adopted only until 2016. So we have implementation law first, then came the accession. So that's all the four different approaches to adopt. Then
as I mentioned, we are trying to incorporate the ICMW and the CPED at this stage, at this time. As far as I understand, we are trying to ratify. We are trying to ratify or assess for the international legal term is assess. We try to assess these two treaties, but there's no proposal for implementing law again. So let's again to the so we have diversified approaches. And the fourth point I try to make about how the application by domestic courts. I do not have much time, but I'll try to give you three questions or problems about the domestic courts. And the first one is that I found there are several judgments that saying that they do not believe that those international human treaties have legal status, domestic legal status at all. Even though the common provision or one of the common provision or implementing laws says that laws wise guaranteed by this international human rights treaty should have domestic legal status. But the judges just try to ignore that provision. And the second problem is that some judges just don't like to apply. Even though it's very clear that these treaties have domestic legal status, because the percentage of the application of these treaties are quite low. And the third problem is for domestic courts is that they do not explain very clearly about standards in international human rights treaties. Yeah, so they often just try to refer to provisions in international human rights treaties, but not the decisions of individual case of individual communications or other standards in international human rights treaties. Yeah, so I've tried to briefly mention three problems for Taiwanese domestic courts. And the last point I try to make is that even I say Taiwan have a status of I did in my way to incorporate international human rights standard and treaties, but there are still something that Taiwan cannot do by ourselves only. Some situation I will try to make three. The first one is about Human Rights Council. Everybody knows that they are UPR. Taiwan cannot join the UPR review. The Universal Periodical Review, although some NGOs can join international NGO groups to attend the meeting of Human Rights Council. But Taiwan cannot officially join the UPR at all. No, not at all. And the second is about individual communications. And Taiwan cannot just incorporate individual in our communication by Taiwan itself, because it needs to be a member of the United Nations and access to some protocols to international human rights treaties, and then accept the individual communication systems. But it cannot do by Taiwan itself only. And the third about state reports. Taiwan cannot send state reports to treaty bodies, not at all. But we create a very unique creation. That's a very invention, a very human invention. We invite independent experts to come to Taiwan to review our state reports. As far as I know, that's a very unique one and probably the only one in the world. A very, very, very good invention in the international human rights regime. I saw the sign. So I guess I'll stop here. If there is further questions that we can discuss, that I'll be happy to answer and have a discussion with us, with all of you. Thank you. Thank you so much.
Well, thank you very much. I'm very happy at last that you mentioned about that review, that international review mechanism, which is very, very unique, of course. Now let's turn to Professor Pawa. Professor Pawa, please.
Hi, thank you. Thank you very much. First of all, I'd like to thank the organizers, especially and the team, and especially Professor Wen Chen for inviting me back in January to participate in this very fantastic enterprise. I have to admit that I was asked to cover the domestic incorporation of human rights in Thailand. And before coming here, I was asked to submit a report of less than 2,000 words. So we academics tend to write more than we are asked to. So in the end, I had to cut things out, and cutting things out was very a challenging task. I named this presentation "Not Quite a Whole New World," and coincidentally, it's from a song, and coincidentally as well, it suits with our honorable moderator because we learned 2 days ago that he likes to sing. So with the name of the presentation, "My Way and Not a Whole New World," I think it suits you. Okay. The reason why I named this is because just to signpost to you that human rights is not something foreign to Thailand. It's Thailand has experiences dealing with human rights issue many times positively. Sometimes, you know, there's rooms for improvement. So very quickly, I would like to divide my presentation into two parts: what's done and what's next. Right, what has been done, what needs to be done, what's the next step. So on what's done, 3 points. I will deal with the legislation, governmental policies, and institutions. So very quickly, Thailand's constitutions, and note the S because we have quite a few, affirm the rights and liberties of people, and no need to go through all that because you can Google Thailand constitution. And at the same time, our criminal law and criminal procedure codes contain several sections that affirm basic human rights. For example, the rights to expeditious, regular, and fair trial, Section 8 and 134. And also, we have sections about the minimum age of criminal responsibility, and we'll get to that later. And in addition, we have acts that incorporate international human rights obligations into Thai domestic law. And to do that, we have to do that through virtue of Section 178 of the current Constitution in 2017, which says that any treaty which requires the enactment of the Act for implementation needs to be approved by the National Assembly. Now it's a parliament, thankfully. So very straightforwardly, to ratify an international obligation, if you have existing law already, then you just go ahead and ratify. Very easy. But if we don't have an existing law, in practice, we sign first just to express the initial commitment. Then we come back and assess whether we need a new law or we need to amend the existing law. Then with all that sorted, we proceed with the ratification and become a state party. So, you know, like putting 1 hour lecture into one slide. Then this is the ratification process. In practice, if we want to ratify a treaty, we let the job of drafting the implementing act, if we can call that the draft, is rested with the responsible agency. For example, the Rights and Liberties Department of the Ministry of Justice, or the Department of International Organization at the Ministry of Foreign Affairs. These are the typical, but if it's more topic related, it's going to be assigned to that particular agency. And then with the draft, you need to go to the cabinet to approve in principle, whether they agree in principle for the draft. Then we need somebody to check, so we send it to the Council of State to examine and prove. Well, the Council of State is the traditional term. Technically, they are legal advisors to the state. They examine, they look at the draft, they do some revision, and once they approve, they send back to the cabinet for approval and confirm the draft before going to the parliament by virtue of Section 178 of the Constitution. And at the parliament, what they approve is that first, for Thailand to become a state party of that treaty, and secondly, to approve that draft because we need the draft to implement that treaty. And then we leave the job to the foreign ministry to prepare, you know, all the logistics to become a state party. So moving on to the substance, as you can see, Thailand is currently a state party to 7 out of 9 human rights core human rights treaty. 7 is highlighted in green. The one that's in yellow is the one that we have signed but not yet ratified, which is the Enforced Disappearance PED convention. The one that we have not signed, not ratified, of course, and we have been made quite a slow progress on this, is the Convention on the Migrant Workers and Members of Their Families. Okay, this is like a holistic picture. But this is, let's look at ASEAN. It's like you buy one, you get 10 from my presentation, right? So in this case, you have the years, you know, that each country ratified that convention in green box, an orange box with the S, that's means you signed but not ratified. And then the red box, of course, you know, the country is not state party. So quite remarkably, Cambodia and Indonesia and the Philippines have ratified, you know, most conventions at 8. And even more remarkably, Cambodia and Indonesia has already signed the remaining convention, so which hopefully they will ratify soon. Malaysia and Brunei, factually speaking, have ratified the least number of the convention at 3, but Brunei has signed the CAT. Singapore and Myanmar each ratified 4, and as Professor Sien Lee has said, Singapore has not ratified the CAT and ICCPR. I hope my information is correct. Okay, thanks. And Thailand, Laos, and Vietnam each ratified 7. So, but I would like you to draw to this fact. Interestingly, all the conventions and all ASEAN member have signed are CEDAW, CRC, and CRPD, all concerned women, children, and persons with disabilities. So, you know, you can see, you know, the perception. And only 2 countries have signed the remaining convention, which is the CMBU, the migrant workers. The rest have not. Okay, move other, and just to briefly highlight on other achievements. We have incorporated some newly enacted human rights obligation. We have newly enacted legislation, for example, the Civil Registration Act, which was amended from the previous version upon recommendation of the Committee Against Racial Discrimination to allow anyone born in Thailand to register irrespective of the origin of the status of their parents. And it, of course, very welcoming, the Gender Equality Act, which was enacted to make unfair gender discrimination unlawful. And Female Title Act, which was enacted to allow women to choose whether she wants to use the title Mrs. or Miss. And other achievements include, you know, includes the ratification of other human rights-related convention, withdrawing certain reservations, and studying the possibility of ratifying more ILO conventions. And with regards to the policy, very quickly, we have the, well, not we, but the government has the plan, the 20-year National Strategic Plan, Thailand 4.0 Economic Models. The 4th National Human Rights Plan is coming up, the National Action Plan on Business and Human Rights, and which hopefully will come out very soon. But well, as you can see, you know, there are some criticisms on the participation, from whether it was holistic, whether all the parties have, you know, been able to get access to the process. And of course, credits must also be given to the civil societies for their input, and sometimes taken, sometimes not so taken, right? So still, it's a process. And also, Thailand also engaged with UPR process. These are some recommendations, the examples of recommendation that was posted by the participating country during the process. And the outcome, you know, like they recommended us that we should do something. Then some of the recommendations we took, and then here's the outcome. You know, like for example, Brazil, Canada, Egypt recommended us on the issue of gender equality. Then the outcome, you know, became the Gender Equality Act in 2015. I have to go through because I'm already 9 minutes. Okay. And very quickly on human rights institutions, we have at the national level, we have Court of Justice, we have the National Human Rights Commission of Thailand, we have the Rights and Liberties Protection Department, and the local administration and municipal governments. And Okay, that's about it. You know, very quickly, that's what's next. But what I would like you to highlight you further is what should be done. And I have a few wishes for Thailand and beyond Thailand, not Taiwan, because you know we are often mistaken. and this is for just for room for suggestion for room for further improvement in terms of incorporation. First, please have the better protection for those who seek protection, and that's where a very powerful statement. For example, for women and LGBT, I see that we need to have a more gender sensitivity. Gender sensitivity must be incorporated into all human rights policy, legislation, and implementation. And for this very specific matter, I hope that the Civil Union Bill, which is very, you know, still hanging there, will be passed soon, so that people who love each other can love each other, and I quote, expressly, right? So I hope that bill will be passed soon. For human rights defenders, better protection for them, please, especially for if they're women, if they're LGBT, if they're people of ethnic minorities, and ensure that there will be no enforced disappearances. For people with disabilities also, make sure that they're not discriminated against, and make sure that, and this is as recommended by the Committee Against Committee for People with Disabilities, make sure that they can get access anywhere and travel freely, and make sure that the facilities are updated or upgraded to accommodate their limitations. For refugees and asylum seekers, better protection, humane treatment for them. Please don't push them to danger. And also, you know, very infamously, the detention center should be sanitized, should be up to the, you know, standard, you know, hygienic, clean, with basic needs, right? And please do not detain children, because, you know, they are, you know, too young. And for children specifically, with the interest time, I'm running out of time, so just to highlight to you that the Committee on the Rights of the Child recommended that the minimum age of criminal responsibility must be set at 12. So in the chart, I see that only 5 ASEAN member countries exceeded that recommendation. The rest are still below the recommendation of the committee. Second, foster genuine collaborations, engagement with other entities, especially with the civil societies, when formulating policies and national action plans must be taken into consideration and extremely important. And genuity is the key, and it must come from both ways, from the government and from the civil societies. And finally, empowering those who need to be empowered, like students, is it time to have a compulsory human rights course? And likewise, civil servants, civil societies, academics, should be given proper training on human rights and international law, and should be continued to improve, and myself included. And then upgrade the National Human Rights Commission. Again, when you get you buy when you get 10. Thailand is has the NHRI of Thailand is now downgraded to B, along with Myanmar, and the Indonesia, Malaysia, and Philippines they all get A status. But I'm not going to say about the rest of the country. But you see the chart. So thank you. So make sure that you know the works of NHRI is upgraded to A status. It make sure there's the independent from the government. And judges are not exception. They should be well versed in international law and international human rights law. I would like to draw you to this. Recently, I came across to this judgment rendered by the Court of Justice, highlighted in yellow. Did you find anything that shouldn't be there? Right. Right. Thailand suddenly become the state party to Universal Declaration of Human Rights. This is, well, this is something, you know, I'm not going to say anything that may, you know, be disrespectful, but you can see from the text that we have a lot of work to do in terms of the judge. I'm not going to say anything. Okay. So, basically, let me end with this. Making our society to become human rights oriented is not an easy task. It requires perseverance and continuous effort from all of us. So you may recognize this line. If you do recognize, then you are my generation, which is not middle age, anyway. sorry. So soaring, tumbling, freewheeling. This line is sung by Lia Salonga from the Philippines, and again, Asian power. Sometimes when we make progress, we soar. Sometimes when things turn against us, we tumble. And sometimes when things are so confusing, we just freewheel, sometimes upside down. But this is typical for the work of human rights and democracy worldwide. You know, we achieve things step by step and managing the obstacles and difficulties. But at the end of the day, we must not lose hope. So I end with that. Thank you.
Thank you, Professor Papa. I like these three, soaring, tumbling, free-wheeling, and to describe human rights condition in Thailand. Lots of dynamics going on. Last but not least, Professor Chandra, please.
Thank you. I should say my task, which was already difficult because I'm the last speaker for the day and all that standing between you and freedom, has been made even more difficult after that presentation because, one, I have no song whatsoever in my presentation, and I've spent the last 15 minutes looking at that wonderful presentation and also racking my brains to think of what song could fit my presentation. I can't think of anything. Second, it's in boring black and white. Now, I wish I'd used color as well. But to make up for it, I'll try and make my presentation as provocative as possible. Okay, so I am going to be looking at India's engagement with international law, including international human rights law, but I'm taking international law as a whole. My presentation is going to be divided into three parts. I'll briefly take you through the status of India's participation in core international human rights treaties, only India's participation, not the rest of Asia or South Asia. I will take you through how international law, including international human rights law, gets implemented in the domestic legal arena in India. And third, I will raise concerns, this is the provocative part, raise concerns with India's approach to how it incorporates domestic law in India, how it incorporates international law in the domestic sphere. Now, to look at India's, the status of India's participation in core international human rights treaties, how do you work this? India has ratified 6 of the 9 core human rights treaties. It has signed 2 others. That's the Convention Against Torture and the Convention on Enforced Disappearances. But despite multiple commitments that it has made to the international community and multiple voluntary pledges, it has not ratified these. Every time India is up for membership at the Human Rights Council, at every single India has gone through 3 UPR cycles. At every UPR cycle, India has made the commitment to ratify these conventions, but for a whole range of domestic reasons, it has not gone ahead and done the ratification. The one that it is neither signed nor ratified is the rights of migrant workers. India's constitution, which came into force in 1950, contains a judicially enforceable bill of rights, which we call the fundamental rights, which broadly maps onto civil and political rights that are generally recognized under, you know, something like the ICCPR. It also contains, in addition, certain cultural and linguistic rights. It also, the Indian Constitution also has a set of judicially non-enforceable but nonetheless binding directive principles of state policy, which require the state to secure socioeconomic justice. And again, these principles broadly map onto the guarantees in the ICESCR. In practice, the distinction between judicially enforceable fundamental rights and non-enforceable directive principles has been dissolved because the court has used the directive principles as interpretative devices to read in and read them into fundamental rights. While India has signed on to of these international human rights conventions, it does not like international accountability for human rights violations. So it has not accepted, as you will see, any of the complaints procedures under any of the treaties that it has signed, nor has it accepted a single inquiry procedure. So it, like I said, it does not like international accountability for its commitments. Now, coming to the question of how is international law implemented in the domestic arena. Now, India follows the British practice with respect to the ratification and incorporation of international law. This is sort of the locus classicus, the classical case in common law jurisprudence, which India also follows. And it says that with respect to treaty law, the power to assume international obligations, which means both to sign and ratify, the treaty rests with the executive. Parliamentary approval is not required for signing or ratifying a treaty. Once a treaty is ratified, it will of course lead rise to international state responsibility, but it has no effect domestically unless Parliament passes an implementing law, implementing that law internally. The reasoning behind this, when the Constitution was being framed, there was a debate about this, but the reasoning behind following this practice was that it gives, on the one hand, the executive the flexibility to engage with its international counterparts. At the same time, it provides for enough parliamentary scrutiny to ensure that there is scope for debate and discussion, and this checks arbitrary executive action, safeguards national interests and national values, and I don't mean values in a very parochial sense, but national constitutional values, as well as safeguard the interests of states. And that is because India is a federal country. Power is divided between the federal government and the state governments. However, when India enters into an international treaty, power, legislative power over that domain and executive power over that domain shifts to the federal government. And that is why the framers felt that having a parliamentary check is very important to also ensure that the federal structure of the country is not disturbed by the executive entering into international agreements and thereby shifting power to the center. So debate and parliamentary scrutiny was seen as very important. So India, therefore, is technically a dualist country. And I say technically because in practice, there are many ways in which international law comes to shape domestic law without any scrutiny by parliament and without any authorization by parliament. I discussed these in my paper, but very briefly, the executive very often brings in international obligations into domestic law through its wide rulemaking powers. For example, if the legislature has enacted a law and has given the executive the power to make rules with respect to that act, the executive through that rulemaking power might bring in various international norms. Parliament has also, in certain cases, given the executive the power to modify the application of the statute in light of new treaties that it might enter. This happens particularly in taxation statutes with giving the power to modify existing tax laws in light of double taxation avoidance agreements, for example, in the context of extradition or in the context of UN Security Council resolutions. These are just examples. Rarely, if ever, will the executive use any of these windows to bring in human rights standards. It's generally used for the kind of norms that increases the power of the state domestically and not for the kinds of norms that limit the power of the state. Now, turning to the judiciary also domesticates international law in various ways, regardless of whether Parliament has domesticated that law. Now, of course, a corollary to the doctrine of the dualism is the doctrine of transformation, which implies that a municipal court cannot enforce international obligations domestically unless accompanied by suitable legislative transformation. However, the Indian Supreme Court has held that, at least since 1984, has held that even without express legislative sanction, international law will be accommodated into domestic law as long as it does not run into conflict with an act of parliament. So rules of international law are incorporated into national law, they become part of national law unless they are in conflict with an act of parliament. So the difference then happens is, under dualism, parliament is required to authorize the internalization of international law. After Gramophone Company, parliament can only resist international law. If parliament does not speak, international law becomes automatically internalized. Now, note that this is a blanket proposition. There's no difference between what other countries that do this kind of incorporation call self-executing or non-self-executing treaties. There's no difference between human rights treaties or other treaties. So this, in this particular case, this was about some customs treaty. So technically, you could have various, treaties like, say, TRIPS, for example, that might come in through or within the TRIPS regime or the international economic law regime that might come in to domestic law and have be applicable in domestic law through this measure. Courts have also placed international law at a constitutional level in the domestic hierarchy of sources. So what the courts have said, and this is again one example, that when there's any international convention, note any international convention, again does not talk about any human rights convention, that would itself be problematic, and I'll come to why, but any international convention which is not inconsistent with fundamental rights, in harmony with its spirit, must be read into these provisions, enlarge the meaning content thereof. And this, what the court is doing here it is relying on this provision of the Constitution, Article 51 of the Constitution. This is part of those directive principles of state policy that are not judicially enforceable. But one of them relates to India's engagement with the outside world, and it says that the state shall endeavor to foster respect for international law and treaties obligations. And the court takes that and says, well, that means that it is our duty as the court to also ensure that there's respect for international law, which means for the court that any law that is not in conflict with the Constitution, we should read into the Constitution, any international law. So therefore, this is a trend towards convergence with international law, including international human rights law. And this wholesale incorporation of international conventions, which are very loosely channeled through fundamental rights, has made the court's approach more close to a direct application of international law domestically rather than some kind of an interpretative incorporation. It's not just interpreting fundamental rights anymore. It's just directly applying international law. And you'll see this in cases where cases come up before the court, where, for example, there's this case where the court poses as a question. This is the constitutionality of a statute which provided for affirmative action for marginalized castes and classes in higher educational institutions. And the constitutionality of that was challenged. And the court poses as a question in a case that is this act in violation of Article 26 of the UDHR, which postulates that technical and professional education shall be generally available and higher education shall be equally accessible to all on the basis of merit. Now, that is what the UDHR says. The Indian Constitution very expressly not only allows for affirmative action, but the courts have in previous cases mandated that it's a duty of the state as a condition of substantive equality to provide for affirmative action. When there is a pushback against this, the pushback has happened in the name of upholding the Universal Declaration of Human Rights. So I want to just, the critical point I want to make, that the use of international law, including international human rights law, is not always necessarily for progressive purposes. And then one has to question what happens when there's this trend towards convergence at all costs, which is the approach that India follows. So that gets me to the concerns that I have with India's approach to domestic incorporation of international law. How should we evaluate this practice? On the one hand, of course, it might be welcomed as a much-needed openness towards a progressive body of norms, particularly international human rights norms. On the other hand, of course, international law itself comes in very different shapes and sizes. Not all international law is progressive, or as progressive as we want them to be. Article 6 of ICCPR that was discussed in the last session is an example. In international human rights law, as it is present in our conventions, is negotiated, is often a political bargain. And the preparatory material behind Article 6 just goes to show that. It's also often in very general abstract terms, and therefore it can be put to good purposes and bad purposes. So to therefore deify these norms and apply them without any examination of what these norms require, how these norms comport with our domestic constitutional norms, may not always end up serving the cause of justice. Upendra Bakshi, a big scholar in India, has cautioned us that there is a trend to import market-friendly human rights, which seek to distort human rights ideology to serve big interests of big business. The right to development in the Indian context is one such example, which has been used by courts to justify the displacement of indigenous communities for the construction of dams, mining, power plants, etc., in the name of the right to development. So there's a politics behind the use and invocation of international human rights law that we should be concerned about. And this a priori assumption of convergence, this push towards convergence, ensures that the court is not critically examining the politics behind the invocation of these norms, not necessarily of the norms themselves. Of course, in addition, third world countries like India have also raised significant concerns about the international economic regime. They have also contested the unequal bargaining power that parties, particularly third world countries, have in the process of negotiation. They often opaque decision-making procedures, and broadly the democratic deficit in international lawmaking. And so for this reason, I would suggest that our openness towards international law should be tempered with some careful evaluation of its suitability in the country's specific domestic context. I am not making a sovereigntyist claim. I'm asking for greater rather than less engagement. I'm asking that there should be greater debate and discussion as opposed to this a priori assumption of convergence. By greater discussion, we are more likely to bring domestic contexts to bear upon international norms and enrich international law in the process as well, and contextualize the application in our domestic context. Because courts should act, right now they act as norm takers, as if international law is a body of norms that they take and apply to themselves. And I'm saying that they should be active participants in the creation, in the co-creation of international law. I will stop here, and if there are any questions, I can take it up in the Q&A session. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Professor Chandra. And thank you all three presentation, all so cooperative that we save some time for discussion. And thank you for the time alert system. It works. Now it's open for floor discussion. Yes, we have 1, 2, 3, 4, possibly 5, okay? Let's begin with the first Professor.
Okay, thank you, Chairperson and Professor Ye. And my question just for three professors. So I think from your presentations, you just shared the story about the domestic incorporation of human rights in three Asian jurisdictions. And I can imagine, the incorporation process in three countries must be very dynamic, and many actors involved in this process. So I'm just curious, in each country, what kind of the factors, encourage or facilitate this incorporation process, and which for example, the pressure from the transnational, human rights network, or the involvement of the, the civil society or the political parties, factors like that. So I'm just curious, which factors is the most important factor? And during this process, does this process face any challenges or any resistance political resistance or any resistance in this process?
So I had a question for Taiwan, either to Professor Liao or to the moderator. What are the chances that Taiwan might integrate international norms in its transitional justice process? In dealing with the past, is there a likelihood that you would draw upon international norms, or are you likely to do it your way? And what do you think the relevance of international norms might be to dealing with the past? I'm hoping you will say yes, and you will then sing we will shock you or something along those lines. But I wanted to also ask Aparna about the politics of international law under the Modi government. Has there been a pushback, especially around civil and political rights? What's your forecast for the next 5 years in terms of international standards and India's politics?
Hey, good, thanks. I forgot, and also, yes, please.
I wanted to ask everyone or one of you, whoever wants to answer, who decides when a treaty is going to be signed or ratified? Is it a minister or is there a parliamentary process? Or what is the process for decision making? And I mean, it's also applied to Taiwan, because although the Taiwan is a very different situation, I think someone does decide to make that decision, not for ratifying, but for not to having a kind of a domestic act. So who decides that?
I have a question to Professor Pawa, Thailand, Pawa, okay. In your outstanding presentation, you introduced a very interesting legislation, Female Title Act. I don't know, can you introduce the social background about the Female Title Act? And give us the more detail about the article. I'm very interested in the article. Thank you.
Okay, last please.
Hi, I'm Anne from TAPCPR, Taiwan Alliance to Promote Civil Partnership Rights. And we're an NGO in Taiwan to promote LGBT human rights. So we're concerned about the LGBT human rights situation in Thailand too. And we have already known that there is an election in Thailand this year, and in 2018, the Minister of Justice has already drafted the Civil Partnership Act, but our friend in Thailand are not so optimistic to this bill because they think it's not the real equality for LGBT.
Can you change the next one? Change to the next one. Oh yeah, good, thanks.
Thank you. And they also think that this bill is just to one government want to raise an image in the international society that Thailand is a pro-human right and democratic state. So my question is, in your view, what kind of role does the election play, and what is the pros and cons that under the domination of military government? Thank you.
Let's have all our presenters to respond to the question. Let's begin with Chandra.
Sure. On the first question of what encourages incorporation, could be a range of factors. In my own experience, where the government has been actively engaged in the negotiation and drafting of a particular treaty, it has more ownership of it, and there's more likelihood that it would be inclined to support that. Its reputation in the international community, India is very concerned about its reputation, particularly at this moment where India is seeking to take on leadership roles in the international community. It's vying for a seat in the UN Security Council and trying to tout itself as a counterbalance to China in the region, etc. It's very concerned about its reputation. And you could see that in the negotiations around CAT. Now, India has signed but not ratified CAT. However, it is under tremendous pressure from the international community to do so. And it's doing, even if it's, these are half-hearted efforts, it's bringing out laws, it's trying to make justifications for how it can sign on to CAT but get away with not making too many changes to its domestic legal regime, so that, again, there is, it doesn't really change things on the ground too much. We have a very robust, very boisterous civil society, which keeps the government, at least as of now we have it, on its tenterhooks. So that's another force. But what is the source of resistance? Frankly, the big source of resistance is, I think governments know that there's the rhetoric of human rights, and they can speak the rhetoric of human rights, but nothing will change on the ground. But when there are laws or international human rights instruments that require actual legal change in ways that might fundamentally shift power. So, for example, the Torture Convention. India has all sorts of reservations to CEDAW, and in the name of, you know, preservation of culture and you know, unique ways of organizing family life, so on and so forth. If you change that, it changes patriarchal power and gender power. And those are the places where you get a lot of resistance, both from the government itself, but also generally from political parties. On Modi and international law, well, you know, our big concern right now is the way he's destroying institutions. We don't know what the prognosis for the next 5 years is going to be. But what the Modi government is brilliant at is doublespeak. So they can speak the name of and the language of human rights while absolutely condoning and just looking away at the grossest violation of human rights, or actively supporting human rights violations in the country. So if you look at Modi's international agenda, he goes around the world. I was told he came to Korea as well, and spoke about Gandhi and peace and etc. And anyone who knows the ideology that he comes from the ideological, the party that assassinated Gandhi. So, you know, he's very good at that. So I don't see India changing its international rhetoric on human rights. Its practice on human rights is deteriorating by the day. And in terms of treaty, who decides? In the Indian context, formally, the decision is taken by the government, typically the Minister of External Affairs. But of course, again, there's a lot of push behind it, just as I was saying in response to the first question, depending on how engaged the Indian government has been in the formation of that treaty, that might come in from the ministry itself, or there might be a push from both international actors, transnational actors, or the domestic civil society. Thank you.
Yes, please.
Okay. Start with the questions on, you know, like what, like just combine two questions together. Like first, what kind of factors encourage the incorporation process, and also link to the other questions on who decides when the treaty gets to be when to ratify a treaty. For Thailand context, in my opinion, the factors at the moment are the international pressure, and to be more specifically, the UPR process plays quite a major role. And because we get lots of recommendation, and in 5 years, if we have not done anything, then you know it shows on the record. So that's, I would say, the pressure that, you know, that encouraged the incorporation process, or the enactment, or the revision, or the amendment of the law. And then, but the challenges is that the prioritization, and this will link me to the question from the audience on civil partnership bill. But I'll get to that later. But the challenge is that on a prioritization, because government has priority when the bill gets through the pipeline, through the process, they have lots and lots of draft bills. So any bill that gets prioritized gets to be voted first. I mean, that's the reality. So the bill, the draft that are considered less prioritized, you know, gets postponed to later stage, and who knows when, right? And that's the first challenge. The second challenge is the participation in the making, in the drafting. Because of course, when you draft a new law, you need to have the participation from stakeholders as much as possible. And there are criticisms that in some stages, there are lack of participation from the ground, from the civil societies. So again, this affects the not the legality, but the image, the ownership of the draft, right? So that's the, I hope it answers the questions. On the Civil Partnership Act, for me, when you look at the current draft itself, it's way behind the marriage, way behind. But there's a reason for that, and I've talked to people who is behind the bill. He's my good friend, and he said that of course we want to achieve the full scale, right? But in reality, there are people who still disagree, and to move things forward, like I said in my presentation, step by step. So if in the current context of the Thai society, we push for the full scale, it affects, there will be resistance, of course, because I don't want to generalize, but from my perception, my own perception, the people of older generation are quite resisting the idea of same-sex marriage. And then there's another challenge in terms of our family law. Because in the Thai context, we have, many, many articles that intertwined and deals and closely connected to the idea of male and female. For example, we have what we call sinsot. Sinsot in Thai means, when you go to engage, the groom's family give a gift. I don't know, some sort of that. Gift, I don't know, to the bride's family. And if you push forward to the same-sex marriage, the whole entire family law, the law that gets that are closely and traditionally linked with this hetero the ideology will have to be revamped. And for many in the team or in the who prepared this, they said that, well, let's go for this step first, and before moving further, of course we are not going to stop here. We will push forward for the full scale. But even let me highlight to you that even with the small scale, I would say civil partnership bill, it gets less priority even now, and before the election. The team hoped that the bill would have been passed before the change of the government. I mean, the person is the same, but the formality. But it wasn't enacted, so the bill got has to be done through the new formation of the parliament, and then with the new formation of the parliament, it gets less priority. So basically, if you want to ask for my view, I would share my friend's stance that of course we all want to have equality. We would certainly want to push for full scale, like Taiwan remarkably did. However, with the limitation in terms of the context, it's step by step, it's better than nothing. It's better than staying still, right? And so to answer another question on Female Title Act, this is another background and that rested in the gender inequality context that was deeply rooted in the Thai society. For those of you who don't know, the title of the person for male, it's always Nai, mean Mister. For women, there are two titles. One, Nang Sao. Nang Sao means Mrs. or those who haven't got married. And then we have a Nang, which is shortened version, but means, you know, a lady who got married. So with this different terms, and when we are recommended that, you know, we have to ensure gender equality, we have to abolish this requirement. But however, instead of saying that, oh, from now on, you have to use Miss, we give a choice. So the women can choose, like, okay, you can use the I'm married or I'm not married, or you know, it can be, or the term can be used as a neutral term, just like what a male would use as, you know, Mr. So it's a compromise in the sense, you know, instead of eradicating the from two options to one, you just let the lady choose, because some, believe it or not, would like to be called a married, you know, lady who is married, and then followed by her name, because just to tell the world that I'm married, I got a husband. But anyway, that's her choice. But at least the law was revised to make this as an option, not as a requirement to change. So I hope this gives you some societal context behind the change of the Female Title Act of Thailand. Thank you.
Okay, Professor Liu. The first question from Professor Lee, that what factor triggered the incorporation of International Human Rights Treaty? I think in Taiwan, we all know, I would call it a historical accident. My personal view is that when we proposed to incorporate International Human Rights Treaty in 2000, we were not well prepared. One evidence that we can check is that when former President Chen declared that what we call human rights policy, one thing is missing. One thing was missing. That's ICESCR. I read the draft. The ICCR was included, but it did not appear at the formal declaration. So I guess there was something like, okay, we need only ICPR, or probably that someone did not know ICSCR at all. So I think I'm going to try to say that's a historical, but it's a good historical accident that it happened, and it continues for the past 20 years. And I think we should go on. Then it's very difficult, it's very interesting. When it's going up, down, not from bottom up, but people seem to accept most of them, except death penalty, for example. Okay, and the second question from Professor Gomez, if I understand correctly, you are focusing on transitional justice. If I understand correctly, I will say that in this field, Taiwan does not try to invent anything at all. We just try to follow some examples in other countries. Because we didn't incorporate international standard in this field at all, nothing at all. Yeah, but we try to follow some example. For example, the Truth and Reconciliation Commission, and we try to enact new laws, and anything. Yes. So it's not invention at all. It's not invention. We try just try to follow. Why was that? My personal view is that because for at this field, it's a political conflict. Because some people in Taiwan will regard all the transitional justice as a revenge. It's very difficult to persuade those people to accept this kind of transitional justice. So only after 2016, it was possible to try to make a new law to establish a new commission and some other laws to find the facts. And to find the facts in the past. So I don't think we will try to invent anything in this field. Mm-hmm. And the last question is about ratification. What factor to mention about the ratification? My understanding is that, in fact, in 2000, we had a blueprint in mind, because I participated in some fields at this work of incorporation of international human rights treaty. That point was try to ratify ICCP and ICERF at first, then to CRC, CEDAW, because it is the most accepted conventions, then to follow into all the 9 core international human rights treaties. But the one accident happened, that was CEDAW. In fact, in Taiwan, the first one to be assessed international treaties is CEDAW. I guess there were 2 reasons. One is political reason, because the DPP government at a lot of time focused very much on ICCPR and ICCR. So it got more resistance from opposition party, that means KMT at that time. So it was more difficult to pass the ratification of ICCPR and ICCR. But for the case of CEDAW, I have to say, women's rights organizations are great and have been great, were great. It's really great. They try to persuade all the legislators in the parliament to pass. So that was an accident that CEDAW became the first one. And the other answer is that there were different approach to adopt or incorporate international human rights treaties. And the other reason is that only the government can propose a bill to ratify the human treaty. But the legislators themselves can propose a bill, a new law. So it's quite different. So that can be decided by 2 factors. One is from government, whether to propose a law to ratify an international human rights treaty. The other is that whether the legislator can join together. For example, CRC and the CRPD, it's a coalition of from different political party to pass the law, implemented law, to implement a law even before we ratify or assess to these 2 international human rights treaties. So that's different. So it could be happen both ways. Yeah.
Thank you very much. I guess Professor Comas was asking about whether Taiwan's implementation of transitional justice has its unique way. My way, you were just saying, and you mentioned that the legislation is, there's no salient feature or any particularities in the bill. But I'd like to share, before the legislation, Taiwan began its democratization, but it's pretty much like a negotiated transition. And transitional justice has to be done, sort of advocated by civil society, but without too much done, except monetary compensation. And that is rather unique, in new democracy. No criminal investigation, no truth-finding commission being set up, except monetary compensation. And for the monetary compensation, there is a law dealing with that. So that may be a little bit unique, but not that unique as you say, the incorporation of international human rights in Taiwan.
No, moderator. May I?
You have a long history of memorials and memorialization and so on, going back. How important is that now in the new transition?
I'm sorry, I didn't get.
You, I mean, if my understanding is right. correct, you have memorials that go back to the 1940s and so on, right? From a different era, like monuments and so on. How important are sort of memorialization, you know, monuments in this part of your transition now?
Monument, yeah. I guess it's a good starting point. The very important one is that we have erected some monuments. It means that we were facing all the issues in the past between 1947 and even 1992. Yeah. So I would say that's a good starting point. But it's only one starting point. That is not taboo. It was not taboo at starting from that time to discuss about all the events or accident of murders between 1947 and 1992. Yeah, but only one point. Yeah, even the monetary compensation is only quite a unique one. But I didn't mention that because I have to say it's not injustice.
Well, I'm afraid we have to close.
This one on Thailand, the law of Thailand, very quick, just only LGBTI okay. law and also election because doctor is not respond about the election. Question from our friend. First point about the LGBTI law, I think that there are very good movement in the LGBTI movement that they also try to put their own law. The law that they also pushing in the parliament right now is also the same-sex marriage that is also put in the parliament already, and they have the agenda already to consider that draft law. But however, because of the order from the government that they want some law that should be approved before this law, because they think that this law, LGBTI law, it is not priority, so they withdraw out from the parliament at that time, and this is also make problem in the movement of LGBTI. The law that they approve is about the security ITX. That is more important than the government because than LGBTI. This is I would like to clarify with same merit law. Usually, Thailand should be also the first the country that will be approved this law. But however, because of the withdrawal of that parliament, so that Taiwan is will be the first country in Asia.
Well,
the second one about LGBTI law is about the title name. The title name that Ajahn explained is it's something that approved already so many years. But the law that is continue that campaign right now, it is the law that changed the name from the transgender people from the man into the woman, and also the woman transgender into man, because in their passport, the man who transgender into woman's in passport put Mr. And then they will be have a lot of problem when they travel. So this is the thing that I would like to clarify. Another point that I would like to clarify about the elections, of course, Thailand has an election on 29 March, but however, Thai people are not happy with the process of the election. The election is something like, so right now we have the election government, but it is the democracy dictator a government that we call it that, because it starts from the drafting constitution that it is not free and fair. It is not make a good constitution, and during the election it is not free and fair because the election commission is also opposed by the NCPO. So everything is under the control of military, and also counting the vote is also controlled by the, and you know that 3 months that the commission election cannot announce the result because of they want to count some to give some seat from the small party to include with the coalition party with the coalition government with this government. So this is something that we are not happy, and we are, I if I didn't say anything, I think that It is my fault that it's not clarified to make everyone understand about the real situation. There are so many things, but I think that the time is up.
Okay, thank you for your update. I'm afraid the time is up for this session. As I say in the very beginning, this is the last session, and I would like to thank you for everyone who stick to, you know, to the end, and particularly these three presenters. They did a good job. Would you please join me applauding them? And I remember Professor Liao, when he began to talk, he mentioned about a song, right? My Way.
My Way. I did it my way.
Do you know how My Way?
Yeah.
What's the first sentence of My Way?
We can talk about later.
It said, and now the end is near. The end is near, and also, we also find the last curtain. That is the conference or all this simulation is near to, is near, is close to end. But the mission that regional human rights court and also this regional concern about human rights, about the incorporation, implementation, we are not saying it's close to end, because it's a long way to go. But at least we have a very good beginning. It's taking shape. And we are going to continue on this journey. Maybe we all have our own way, but hopefully there will be a regional way, or Asian way, come up and make this, you know, journey, you know, concluded in a good way. With that, thank you very much.
Thank you. This concludes today's session, and now Professor Liao Fuhe, judge of AHRCS, will deliver a farewell speech.
All right. I can do this, but if I may, I'll prefer to still be seated. Okay, all my friends, thank you very much for stay until now and all participate all the events. And we all living in a human society, and it's very regret a lot. Even a very wonderful and outstanding event at the end has to come to the end. And we will do it my way. Okay, so I was assigned to say something at the end of this meeting, and I have feeling lots or not feeling lots. If this is not a torture, at least it is a crucial or inhuman treatment to me. I thank to give it this opportunity to to say some words to all of you. I think we are sharing our common goals to establish Asian Human Rights Court. At this time, our approach is by stimulation, and we will continue our work. At the end, as Professor Ye said, at the end, a real Asian Human Rights Court has been established. We will keep our work. And at this time, we try to arrange two parts. The first one is a trial of a case, Chou Hosen versus Republic of China, Taiwan. And the other part is that we include keynote speech and some workshops. And of course, we will search your advice for future works. And if you have any suggestions to make, please try to tell us. And of course, I'll try to say that if I remember correctly, we will have next trial 2 years later in 2021. And we are trying to establish several groups or committees, including legal, education,
and try to include financial resources, a special group for financial resources. And I, on behalf of the Taiwan Foundation for Democracy, we are honored to support this event. And I can try to assure that we will try to offer our best to support the coming event for in 2021. We'll try to our best to support, provided that I continue to be the president of Taiwan Foundation for Democracy. So thank you so much. And on behalf of the organizers, I would like to thank all the honorable justices at this Asian Human Rights Court, and the two groups of attorneys from applicant and the defendant, although they are not here. And in fact, they are all friends. They are friends, although they stand for two sides. In fact, they are friends in the real life. Yeah. And I was thanks all the independent experts, scholars, and all our friends from NGOs domestically in Taiwan and internationally from other countries. I would like also to thank our volunteers. We have many, many, many volunteers. Without them, this event could not be possible. Yeah. And of course, we all thank very, very hardworking colleagues and friends at our secretariat. And some of them are here. Yeah, they have been working for a long, 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 long time. And in some occasions, I even received nice at early morning. And I received more than 1,000 emails during the preparation. I want to thank all our colleagues at the secretariat. And also, I try to thank all the organized and the co-organized. We are very great to have all our organizations to work together. It's a very good experience. And last but not least, of course, the very important, because according to the custom, when a musical or opera comes to an end, when all the actors or players want to pay gratitude to all the audience, it's always a custom that the most important actors are coming to the stage at the last. So at the last, I will mention two very, very important and key persons during our preparation and this event. They are Professor Zhang Wenzhen and also Professor Xu Yixiu. Without them, it's not possible to prepare this event. So please welcome our very key persons. Yeah. So you have to pay gratitude to our audience. So we will shoot hand and say thank you.
So okay. We just like to thank, as much as we have done, I think you have done more to come all the way here to join with on this unprecedented enterprise endeavor. And then we are looking forward to working with you all until Asian Human Rights Court will be accepted. Thank you.
Thank you.
Let me express my deepest gratitude to all judges, expert witnesses, MSC's QA, advisors, NGOs and sponsors from Taiwan, Sri Lanka, India, Thailand, United Kingdom, Australia, and Korea, Japan, Malaysia, Singapore, Hong Kong, Hungary, of course, and I forget some. And, Bangladesh, yes. In particular, Judge Zhang Wenzhen and Secretary General Huang Renxian for spending 1 year, 1 year, and 7 judges of chamber for spending 9 months, and secretariat staff for 1.5 year, jointly promote the realization of the human, Asian Human Rights Court simulation.
We will invite all our colleagues at the secretariat to come to stage to pay gratitude to all our friends. Yeah. Okay. They are shy.
Are you shy?
Mm-hmm. Can we? Can we? No, I insist that we have to do that. I do believe that all of you agree with me. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Yeah, thank you. Thank you so much. Thank you. Yeah, there. Are they coming? All right, all right. Okay, so please. Yeah, thanks all our colleagues in the secretary. Yeah, thank you so much again. Thank you.